Welcome to the U.S. Bank NBC Sports Report.
And hi again, everyone. Jimmy Roberts in our NBC Sports studios, back out to Fenway for kickoff shortly. But first, moment to catch you up on the day's scores and highlights. And we start with the defending national champion. Ohio State is undefeated and third ranked. But so far this year, not a single game against a ranked opponent. That changed today. Buckeyes hosting number 9 Michigan State at the Horseshoe. Spartans without longtime starting quarterback Connor Cook, out with a shoulder injury. Tight game here, third quarter. McGarrett Kings Jr. muffs the punt. Ohio State recovers on the Michigan State 6-yard line. So on the next play, JT Barrett finds Jalen Marshall, 6-yard touchdown. Buckeyes take a 7-point lead. Then in the fourth, Spartans' Gerald Holmes breaks the plane of the goal line, ties the game. And then it all came down to this. 3 seconds left. Michael Geiger, 41 yards to give the Spartans the 17-14 win. Yeah. So the nation's longest winning streak ends at 23, but this changes everything. Michigan State definitely now back in the playoff picture and can win the Big Ten East by beating Penn State next week. Country's number 1 team, Clemson, hosting Wake Forest. First quarter, Clemson already up 7-0. Deshaun Watson going to work, finds Sharon Peak, 44 yards, touchdown. Second quarter, Clemson now up 13, and Watson again, this time connects with Jermon Hopper, 47 yards on the touchdown. Tigers by 20 at that point. Clemson extends its win streak to 14, their longest since the 1940s. The Tigers are at South Carolina next week before facing North Carolina in the ACC championship game. Number 2, Alabama hosting Charleston Southern. First quarter tied off to a good start, and why not when it's in this man's hands, Derrick Henry, 17-yard touchdown, 7-0, Alabama. Later in the first, more Bama, Jake Coker, Richard Mullaney, 21 yards on the score, 21-0. Crimson Tide. Still in the first, Charleston Southern punting, and the kick hits one of their own men in the foot. Cyrus Jones picks it up. He's gone. 43 yards for the score. Actually, Jones had 2 touchdowns on punt returns on the day. 28-0 at that point, and the romp was on. The Buccaneers get blown out, but they'll earn $500,000 for making the trip, and that is how they finance their program, which, by the way, won the Big South this season. Alabama is at Auburn for the Iron Bowl next week. SEC, couple of ranked teams, LSU and Ole Miss. Les Miles feeling the heat, 2 straight losses. Third quarter, Ole Miss up 24-17. Chad Kelly hit at the goal line. Play is reviewed and called a touchdown. Kelly, 4 touchdowns on the day, 2 rushing, 2 passing. Then, later in the third, same score. Kelly to Evan Ingram, 36 yards on the touchdown. 38-17, Ole Miss at that point. And then LSU now with just seconds left. LSU with its first 3-game losing streak since 1999. As I said, the heat is on Les Miles. Ole Miss can win the SEC West with a win at Mississippi State and an Alabama loss. And that's a perfect opportunity to remind you that we're switching to the track. The NASCAR Xfinity Series final earlier today. Kyle Larson takes the checkered flag, his first win of the season. But more importantly, 23-year-old Chris Buescher takes the Xfinity Series title. He wins the championship in only his second season. And tomorrow, Jeff Gordon suits up for one final time as he looks to go out on top with a 5th Sprint Cup championship. Coverage gets started at 1:30 Eastern. All right, that'll do it for now. We will see you again at halftime as 4th-ranked Notre Dame takes on Boston College. Kickoff is coming up next.
This has been the U.S. Bank NBC Sports Report.
What excitement we have here in Fenway Park.
And here is Ted's last at-bat.
For more than a century, this old ballpark has seen plenty of the incredible.
There it goes, a long drive. If it stays fair, home run.
History and heartbreak, legendary figures, and unforgettable moments.
Swing and a drive, deep right, it's gone! The Red Sox have won it!
But until now, never the matchup that seems such a perfect fit for a fall Saturday. And while Fenway may have just enough room for this game, it offers no shortage of imagery and atmosphere for this rivalry.
Looney back to throw, blitz is on, fires a pass, it is incomplete.
For more than four decades, these two teams, bonded by the identities of their schools, have tested each other at critical times.
Got it! Just beat the number one team in the nation.
The result has been a collection of enduring memories that have stood the test of time. Now, tonight, with the college football playoff beckoning, the Fighting Irish of Notre Dame have everything to play for, while the Boston College Eagles have nothing to lose in a reunion of two old rivals in the great city of Boston's story, Fenway Park. Historic Boston on a beautiful Saturday night, and among its most treasured and iconic sights, the oldest ballpark in Major League Baseball, Fenway Park, home of the city's beloved Red Sox. But tonight, for the first time in nearly 50 years, a football game is about to break out in the seventh edition of the Shamrock Series as the Boston College Eagles take on the fourth-ranked Fighting Irish of Notre Dame. And since Notre Dame is the home team, even though the Boston College campus is less than 4 miles away, Irish fans have taken over Fenway, soaking in the atmosphere featuring that world-famous green monster, which, instead of seeing right-handed batters take aim on it, will settle to serve as an Irish green backdrop presiding over that gridiron now laid out in front of it. And Notre Dame, as the home team, they will enter the field from the first base Red Sox dugout. And befitting a game at this green cathedral of baseball, the Irish in green uniforms for the first time in 5 years, for the first time ever in all green. An electric and unique setting. The heavily favored Irish looking to stay focused on a national championship run as they go for their sixth straight win since that lone loss of the season to Clemson more than a month and a half ago.
Hey, watch your hands.
And then you've got the Boston College Eagles as they gather from the visitors dugout, also with special uniforms for this game tonight, their throwbacks, which celebrate the 30th anniversary of that 1985 Cotton Bowl victory, the same season their most famous football alum, Doug Flutie, threw that Hail Mary pass to beat Miami. But Notre Dame will come across the field first. Fenway Park, here come the Irish. What a scene at Fenway. Steve Addazio fired up to get his Boston College Eagles out onto the field. Very trying season for the team just down the road in Chestnut Hill. 3-7 on the year, winless in the ACC, six straight losses, but with a history of playing spoiler to Notre Dame title hopes of the past. And there's Addazio in his third season after two straight bowl appearances. Now finds his team reeling down the stretch, but inspired to defend what really is their home turf here in Boston. So is there an upset in the making for the Boston College Eagles? So with a kickoff, not the first pitch coming up in just a few minutes, we go down to Catherine Tappan. Catherine.
Coach, you grew up in Boston. You came to Red Sox games as a kid with your dad. Could you ever have imagined coaching Notre Dame football at Fenway Park?
No, I could imagine maybe coming to a ball game, but they've done a great job. Everybody at Fenway Park, has been terrific, Sam Kennedy and his entire team. So we're just pleased that we've been able to get the Shamrock Series here in Boston, and now we're going to play, you know, a very tough Boston College football team. We've always played great games, and this will be another one tonight.
You guys are 6-0 in Shamrock Series games, but you face the number one defense tonight in Boston College. What do you have to do to be successful against this talented defense?
Well, first of all, you got to obviously find a way to run the football against them. They're very stingy. And then take your shots down the field when you get your opportunities, because it's going to be a difficult, obviously, chore for our offense.
Coach, thank you very much. And Dan, as you mentioned, both teams are going to operate on the same sideline here tonight, and they will be separated by just 10 yards. And in this area where I am, this is the neutral territory. Both teams telling us they practice this, they rehearse this routine. It requires lengthy preparation with regards to the substitutions. And at any given point, the teams can travel 30 or more yards to get to a potential situation. So it's all part of the unique charm here at Fenway Park, Dan.
Everybody shifted around a bit for this one, Catherine, including us, not in the traditional baseball announced position behind home plate, but high above the right field line, which tonight finds us right above the 50-yard line. So with that, we welcome you to Fenway Park. Doug Flutie, we've got the Green Monster behind us. This is always a special place to play any kind of sport, but you know personally how great the magic is here at Fenway.
I have so many memories here. I mean, as a kid, all the kids in the neighborhood get together. We take the T into the city, $6 for a bleacher seat. We get there early as soon as the gate opens so we can get up front and get some home run balls and batting practice and all that. It's 40 years later, I'm doing the same stuff. I just have better seats now. Yeah,
so a lot of hype surrounding this game. Notre Dame trying to stay focused, still in that fourth position in the college football playoff rankings. And they're taking on the top-ranked defense in the country. So it is a good time to get your top running back, C.J. Procise, back.
Yeah, and he is approaching the 1,000-yard mark. They need him in there because it is a tough defense to run the ball. It's going to be tough sledding. He's going to have to pound it in there. He's got a great combination of power and speed. When he hits a crease, he is gone. They need that running game to set up the play action big play.
As we said earlier, Boston College with the top ranked defense in the country. It is on the opposite end of the spectrum when you consider the BC offense worst ranked in the country. They've now gone through four quarterbacks, and they start for the second time a walk-on freshman at quarterback in John Fadul tonight against the Irish.
John Fadul brings a toughness and an energy level, though, to this offense. Yes, he's inexperienced. They may cut down the playbook, but he runs tough. The other guys rally around him. He's got a strong arm, but his biggest challenge is to still be aggressive but not turn the ball over.
Well, if you were with us in the pregame, you saw the moment of silence observed for Doug Flutie and his family, Doug losing both of his parents earlier in the week on Wednesday. And I know this has not been anything. This has been very tough for you, but I know how much you wanted to be at this game tonight.
Mom and Dad wanted me to do this game. I mean, the entire family circled this date on our calendars when it was announced. And some of the happiest memories of my parents' lives were watching their sons and grandsons play Boston College football.
Well, we're so happy that you're here, Doug. And we're going to kick it off at Fenway Park here in just a couple of moments. As Boston College wins the toss and defers, so Notre Dame will have the ball at Fenway Park for the first time. In the first football game since 1968, nearly 50 years. Colton Lichtenberg to put it in play for Boston College, and C.J. Sanders stands back deep for Notre Dame, 9-1 on the year. And a low kick by Lichtenberg. And that goes out of bounds, so Notre Dame will have good field position up at its 35-yard line with the flag.
Free kick out of bounds on the kicking team. Ball will be placed at the 35-yard line. First down.
So DeShawn Kizer brings the Irish out. And quiet game for him and his favorite target, Will Fuller, last week. As you take a look at the DirecTV starting lineups, just three catches for Fuller. But again, they've got Procise back there in the backfield. Up front, Ronnie Stanley, the projected first-round pick, and the rest of that impressive offensive line. But they're going to have their hands full with that impressive Boston College front seven. So here's DeShawn Kizer, who along with Fuller did have a quiet game last week, just 111 yards passing in the win over Wake Forest, 28-7. And so he comes right to the air up the get-go, and it's a good grab there by Amir Carlisle at the 45, and he might have picked up the first down.
Right away, Notre Dame spreads out the Boston College defense, taking away that physicality on the inside game.
Carlisle just short of the first down, so bring up second down and less than a yard. You can see the seams in the sod there just in front of Kaiser, which has been covered up the infield here normally at Fenway. And Kaiser gives it up the middle and picking up the first down indeed is C.J. Procise, who comes into this game just 25 yards short of a 1,000-yard season as the flag comes in.
Illegal formation on the offense, five men lined up in the backfield, 5-yard penalty. Second down.
So the first down goes off the boards, and so does Procise's first carry. Second and six.
Right away, Notre Dame tried to go a little bit of tempo there, line up quickly. The first play was a spread set. Boston College's advantage, or their strong suit, is their inside seven. If you spread that out and create a six-man box, it gives Notre Dame a chance to run the football.
Kaiser with three split to his right. He'll hand it off, and getting nowhere is Procise. Brought down by Mehdi Abdesmah, the big 6'7", 286-pound senior from Montreal, Quebec.
He just closes down right here. Closes down and throws McGlinchey and makes the play. This is the strength of that Boston College defense. They are leaving their defensive backs one-on-one all over the field right now. But now it's a long yardage situation, and it appears they may go some zone.
Number one in total defense and a couple of other categories, that stingy BC defense, which knows it has a lot on its shoulders tonight with the way the offense has played all season. Kaiser stands in on third and five and completes it at the 48-yard line. And that is good for Amir Carlisle to pick it up, gain a seven.
I couldn't even tell you what the coverage was on. They were all over the map defensively on that play, trying to disguise their looks. Great job by Kaiser just making a quick read out to the outside.
So Notre Dame shakes off the penalty, picks up the first down, and keeps this opening drive alive at the 47. Here's Procise coming off the concussion last week. And Procise with a huge gain down the near sideline. Brought down by Justin Simmons. So Procise with a nice gallop of 31 on that play.
It's Landry on the outside coming down, and he gets fooled, and Procise gets on the perimeter and off and running. The key to this running game right now is spread the Boston College defense out.
In the words of Kelly, C.J. Procise has fresh legs. Not playing last week. In fact, it's been a couple of weeks really since he's played after he got injured in the first quarter. And Kaiser locking it up toward Will Fuller, and a flat comes in late. That's Gabriel McClary on the coverage of Fuller.
Well, the back judge from further away actually threw this flag.
And they're pass interference on the defense, number 14, 15-yard penalty, first down.
So it is on the sophomore, McClary.
McClary's one-on-one on the outside, and Will Fuller can run by anybody. He gets a step, the ball's a little underthrown, and Will Fuller does a great job of it. He slows down to the ball to create the contact, and that is a call. Contact was made before the ball got there.
So it goes all the way down to the 7-yard line where the Irish have it first and goal. Kelly said, we want to be more aggressive this week offensively, move Fuller around, as Wake Forest got the better of them in that department many times. Here's Kaiser rolling to his right, and that is picked off by John Johnson, who stepped right in front of the Irish receiver to shut down this Notre Dame drive in a hurry.
Kaiser gets on the perimeter, decides he really doesn't have anything, was probably thinking of throwing this ball away, but he tries to put the ball back to the inside and lead his receiver back across. Poor decision. Johnson, good body position, was able to see the ball thrown.
Johnson, normally a safety, pressed into duty at the corner position, and Steve Addazio likes what he sees so far as Eagles take over on the turnover. Notre Dame football on NBCSN is brought to you by Mercedes-Benz, the best or nothing. By State Farm, find your agent at statefarm.com. And by Coke Zero, all taste, zero calories. You don't know zero till you've tried it. So there you look at the fast-paced transformation of Fenway Park baseball facility into a football field. Some 24,000 square feet of sod laid in the infield and the surrounding areas to turn it into this football night at Fenway. And Notre Dame turning the ball over, interception by Boston College, trying to take advantage of it. And here is John Fadul on his first play, takes it around the right side for a couple. As we check out more of our DirecTV starting lineups, the Boston College Eagles on offense. Well, the worst ranked unit in the country. Their leading rusher averages 30 yards a game and all sorts of problems up front that have led to more of the problems for all of the quarterbacks. There's Paris Williams, a six-year senior who's really got the most experience there. And down on the turf right now is Jalen Smith for Notre Dame, the leading tackler for the Irish, and having himself a great season.
That would be a big loss if he's not cut. He's getting up pretty good there.
Pops up. Again, Notre Dame is without the services of James Onwalu. He's the latest starter to be out of the lineup due to injuries. And there's the pop on Fadul that Smith laid on him. Smith tied a career high with 14 tackles last week. And now he takes a break as Fadul picked up three. Tavon Coney is into the game now for the Irish on defense. Whistles come in. And another flag flies in.
False start. Offense, number 67. 5-yard penalty, second down.
That called on the left tackle, Aaron Montero.
They were trying to set up a jet sweep there for Thad Smith, and the timing of it was off, and he had the stutter step. So your quarterback winds up hesitating on the cadence, and the offensive line jumps.
John Fadul spent the first 8 weeks on the scout team for Boston College. This is his second collegiate start. He took over for Troy Flutie in the Virginia Tech game after a couple of series. Started the game, the last game for Boston College in their latest loss. But here he is. He's very aggressive, fearless kind of runner, and he'll stick his shoulder and his helmet in just like he did there to the Notre Dame defense for a big pickup for Fadul.
This is a great job. It's a great play call, actually, a 3-by-1. There's three receivers to the field, only one to the boundary, and they had a numbers game on the backside. It was well blocked, and Tyler Rouse threw a great block, and Fadul is not afraid to take a hit. He's putting his shoulder down. He's running hard. Both his decision on the zone read on the first play of the game and that one, he's running hard.
Gain of 19 for Fadul, who grew up 20 minutes from here in Wellesley, Mass. Spent 3 years at Milton Academy. Then he went on to Wellesley, where he passed for 3,000 yards. And here he is, the starter against fourth-ranked Notre Dame. Picks up a big first down there. So now from the 38, they swing it outside to Tyler Rouse. Just a moment ago, we said that their top rusher averages 30 yards a game, and there he is, Tyler Rouse, who stands just 5'8".
The difference here is you have a tight end formation. Everybody's in the box, and Notre Dame just penetrates and gets in the backfield. This is a young offensive line, inexperienced for Boston College. Their good running plays so far have come out of spread formations. When you're in tight, you load up that box, you've got to blow people off the ball to get room.
That was Kavare Russell, who wrestled Fadul down for a loss of five. Jalen Smith back in the lineup for Notre Dame. Fadul looking to the near side and out of the arms of David Dudek, who leads the team in receptions with 14, but it'll bring up third and long.
Brian Van Gorder, defensive coordinator for Notre Dame, dialing up another blitz. And that's his MO. That's what he likes to do. He likes to pressure people, especially when you have a young quarterback. He's not going to hesitate to bring it. He will get a lot of looks. Brian Van Gorder spent some time in the NFL, and he dials up everything.
So third and 15 for Fadul. Fadul just runs it right up the gut, gets it across the 35. It'll still bring up fourth and long, and Boston College will have to punt it away. Isaac Rochelle up there, who's been moved to the inside with some of the injuries up front for Notre Dame. Daniel Cage continues to be out of the lineup for the Irish.
And that, by moving him down inside, Andrew Trombetti starts at the defensive end spot. There was a third and long situation. I think Adazio just did not want to turn the ball over and put his quarterback in a situation where he forces the ball down the field. Took a shot at the quarterback draw.
So this is Alex Howell to punt it away for Boston College. He has been used a lot this year. And C.J. Sanders gets popped back at about the 22-yard line. So good special teams by Boston College, as Matt Milano made the special teams tackle for Boston College. No score, 9.5 in the first. Special night for Notre Dame head football coach Brian Kelly, who threw out the first pitch this summer at Fenway Park. Ceremonial first pitch for the Red Sox. Born in Everett, Mass, as we look at his Massachusetts background. Raised in Chelsea, and there is the Kelly House. 6 miles north of Fenway, and then prepped at St. John's in Danvers, and then went on to play college football at Assumption College in Worcester, where he was a linebacker as well as the coach there, the team captain. So, Doug, you're from these parts. Special night for Kelly, no doubt.
It really is. I watched some Assumption basketball as a kid. And then Kelly goes to Assumption, and the first year out of school, he's coaching already. He's had that coaching in his blood through his playing days. He knew his destiny.
And here he is with his team in the hunt for a national championship. Still Stanford to go next week, and then we'll see how it all shakes out. But 9-1, trying to move it to 10-1. But a costly turnover on the previous series for Deshaun Kizer. Interception thwarted that drive. Here's C.J. Procise, who's already over 1,000 yards. That's his third carry of the night. Another good gain brought down by Steven Daniels. As C.J. Procise joins Sierre Wood as just the second 1,000-yard rusher in the last 9 seasons at Notre Dame. And again, Doug, this is a guy in his first year as a running back, just his 9th career start.
Absolutely amazing. They were going to use him sparingly at the tailback position coming into this season, and he has been the workhorse.
Just across the 30. And Kizer going deep downfield, and another nice catch there by Carlisle. So Amir Carlisle moves the chains, and Notre Dame into Boston College territory after a gain of 26.
Carlisle in the slot, former running back, a wide receiver now, runs a great upfield route on the corner route, runs away, and what a beautiful throw over the top. Turns his body, good body position to catch the football.
Carlisle with his third reception, already 42 yards. Kizer on the ground. He's had good success in recent games doing that. And a good gain by Kizer. That'll bring up second down and short. As we take a look at the defense of this formidable Boston College team, DirecTV starting lineups. Maybe the most talented up front there was Harold Landry. Then you got Steven Daniels, senior leader at middle linebacker, and the team's leading tackler. Injuries at the corner position, as we mentioned, John Johnson moves into that cornerback position after playing safety. He was the guy that picked up the earlier interception as Will Fuller gets the call and I believe the first down. But another flag is down. Busy night so far for ACC crew and referee David Epperle.
Are you shitting me? Are we gonna get hosed all night?
Offside on the defense, 5-yard penalty, results in a first down.
By the way, Steve Adazio and the Boston College sideline have been issued a warning for coming onto the field, as a couple of calls have heated up Adazio early.
He's intense. If he doesn't like something, he's going to let the officials know, and he doesn't realize quite how far he gets out there. He doesn't waste any time getting into it either.
Notre Dame just inside the Boston College 30 with a new set of downs. Kizer fakes it. Quick hitter to Torrey Hunter Jr., and he picks up another first down inside the 20. Justin Simmons is out there, and they finally wrestle him down just outside the 5. That's a gain of 23 for Torrey Hunter Jr.
hard play action, so he slides behind Milano and makes the easy catch, and then he doesn't quit. He won't go to the ground. He did not. He fell on a body, put his hand down, and kept going.
There he is.
He gets spun, falls on a body, puts the four. Oh, he's
elbow.
Down. The elbow
the
touch.
The elbow went down.
It was not a hand. It was an elbow.
The previous play is under further review.
But if you don't hear the whistle, you keep going.
It's not the first time that we've seen a Torrey Hunter fly around Fenway Park, is it?
Of course, there was one that flew into the bullpen.
His dad, the Major League Baseball star who just retired this season, flew over not too far away from where his son just flipped over there. But the elbow down means that Torrey's down.
Yeah, there's no doubt his forearm touched the ground. This will come back to this point. I'm trying to figure out what yard line it is. But along those lines of talking about his father flying over the wall when Big Poppy hit a crucial home run, Torrey wanted to reenact that yesterday in the walkthrough. He wanted to go out and jump over the wall and get the picture and all. They just didn't have quite enough time.
Yeah, game two of the World Series, or the AL Championship Series, I should say, back in 2013. There was Big Poppy. Bases loaded. And Torrey Hunter Jr.'s dad, Torrey, made a great, valiant try for it. There's the famous picture of the policeman in the background.
See, I wanted to reenact the policeman as he reenacted the jump.
And there is the wall that dad went over. And we were on the field when the Notre Dame players arrived for the first time here to Fenway Park, and all the teammates of Torrey Hunter Jr. were trying to get him over there and reenact his dad's flip over the wall, and they were going to do it, and then cooler heads prevailed. So we got a football game to play. We can't be flying over the wall.
He may do it after the game.
I'll tell you what,
in that game, the Red Sox had not done anything the entire game. They had one opportunity down four runs, loaded the bases, and Poppy came through.
And Hunter has been coming through for Notre Dame.
After review, the runner was down at the 18-and-a-half yard line. The play will result in first and 10 at the 18 and a half. Please reset the game clock to 7:43 and wind on my whistle.
So that brings it back 12 yards as they had it marked at the 6. Here's Notre Dame in those all green uniforms. Of course, they've had green jerseys in the past, but the first time ever in all green. And then Doug, you're probably feeling right at home watching the Boston College uniforms.
Those uniforms look cool. Yeah, that looks familiar to me. That's a throwback to 84. The Notre Dame uniforms, I'm colorblind, and those numbers are hard to read. I'm sorry.
I'll do my best here for you.
I end up going to the monitor to read the numbers.
So first and 10 for Notre Dame at the Eagle 18. Halfway through the opening quarter at Fenway Park. CJ Procise maybe gets a couple. Connor Wojak, part of that BC defensive front, on the stop. Connor Wojak, number 90 there. Father was an offensive guard on the Notre Dame 1973 national championship team. There's a lot of family connections back and forth through BC and Notre Dame through the years.
Wojak is a stud. He's their best defensive lineman.
So a pickup of just one by Procise brings up second and 9. Eagles showing pressure, and they come right in the backfield. They bottled up Procise as Kaiser tries to loop around, and then the ball gets loose, and Boston College says they have it, and they do. Second turnover for Notre Dame.
What an effort by Daniels coming from the backside. Did not quit. He takes Procise first, fights through Procise, and keeps getting after Kaiser. Coming from this side of the screen. Comes down, takes on CJ Procise, and says, the heck with it, I'm going to get after Kaiser. Punches the ball loose. Boston College comes up with it.
Well, let's check out Kaiser. His knee appears to be down just before Daniels came in to help force the fumble. So
it's pretty simultaneous. Daniels' hand, or yes, Stephen Daniels' hand is on the ball and starting to rip as the knee goes to the ground. The ball comes out very quickly after that, but it has to be conclusive to turn it over.
So they're going to take another look at it, and we'll see if Notre Dame commits its second turnover in as many possessions in the red zone. Coverage provided by Goodyear. Whether you drive 100 yards or 100 miles, choose Goodyear tires for superior performances. Goodyear, more driven.
After review, it was determined the runner's knee was down with the ball at the 13-yard line. It will be Notre Dame ball, third down at the 13.
I agree with the call. I thought his knee was down, but it was so close, I didn't know if they would overturn this call. It's so close. Boy, that's close.
And again, so important, the call on the field, because in order to reverse it, you have to have indisputable video evidence.
I think it's the right call. I think his knee did touch before the ball came out.
Has to be beyond all doubt, and apparently it was. So the ball stays with Notre Dame. They avoid their second straight turnover in the red zone. And you see the numbers for Kaiser this season. Now with a third and five from the BC 8. 13, I should say. Kaiser from the shotgun, lofting it up to the end zone, incomplete. Double covered there was Alize Jones, Kaiser's target on the previous series, which ended up in an interception. And that'll bring up fourth and five, and a few
on Connor Strahan. Great job by the linebacker Strahan, running stride for stride with the safety over the top. There was a tight window for Jones to have an opportunity.
And so this will be an opportunity for another local product. In fact, Justin Yoon, the Notre Dame field goal kicker, went to the same Milton Academy on the same team as the BC quarterback John Fadul. And he's made seven field goals in a row dating back to a couple of games ago, and he makes it eight straight with that 30-yarder for Justin Yoon to open up the scoring at Fenway Park. Notre Dame 3, Boston College nothing. 6 minutes left in the opening quarter. The tradition continues. Black Friday just got darker with a 2015 Discover NHL Thanksgiving Showdown. Rangers Bruins Friday, 1 Eastern time on NBC. Big sports town, Doug. You know all about the sports craziness that we've seen here through the years, whether it's baseball, hockey. You got the New England Patriots with a perfect record and a Monday night contest looming. And there's that manually operated scoreboard at Fenway turned into a football scoreboard tonight, and it shows the Irish with the early 3-0 lead as Tyler Newsom gets ready to send it Boston College's way as Michael Walker stands back deep, and he's going to give way here at the 5-yard line to David Dudek, who steps up and gets it across the 15. So Boston College will have its latest field position there as we check in with Catherine.
Well, Dan, yesterday Deshaun Kaiser told us they were going to be using wristbands and screens for this game, given that both teams are on the same sideline. He meant actual screens. This is what Notre Dame rolled out at the start of the game. The BC coaching staff was chirping them, saying, what do you got, guys changing behind there? So this is what they bring out, these Powerade towels. And then they realized that wasn't working so well, so they brought out a bigger flag. And at one point, Joe Schmidt for Notre Dame turned and said, this is crazy. I mean, it definitely is an interesting dynamic down here, Dan.
Well, there's that 10-yard neutral space occupied by a few members of the media and whatnot, but there are the two teams on the same side of the field because that was the only way they were able to do it, the way this football field was configured here. As Boston College starts out with a handoff to Tyler Rouse as we check out another DirecTV starting lineup. And Notre Dame's defense, they continue to be led by the two-time senior captain Sheldon Day up front. You see Andrew Trombetti there getting the start at one of the end positions as Rochelle has moved inside. And Jalen Smith at linebacker continues to pace the team in tackles in the secondary, which has had its ups and downs through the course of the year. Looks to Kavari Russell at the corner for leadership, and he's also provided a couple of late key interceptions for Notre Dame down the stretch of this season. So second down and 9 for Fadul, the walk-on from Wellesley. And Tyler Rouse gets the call. Just 5'8". A lot of guys on the short end of the physical spectrum, Doug, here at Boston College. Rouse got one Division I scholarship offer, and it came from Boston College, and he's taking advantage.
But, you know, he's a physical runner. He's not an all-purpose back, but he is a physical runner. He'll stick his nose in there, get the tough yards for you. There he's one-on-one with Jalen Smith and just puts his shoulder into him, gets what he can. Steve Adazio wants to keep this offense in good down and distance and not put his young quarterback in tough situations.
Well, passing situation here for Fadul. He gets pressure right away, and down he goes. And right there in the backfield, Sheldon Day and company. They just swarmed on Fadul.
Right tackle Dave Bowen went for a cut on Sheldon Day, and he just couldn't get it. Right here, 74, goes for the cut block, can't get it. Sheldon Day, great athleticism for a big man to stay on his feet and make the play.
Sheldon Day, who's watched his mate Romeo Okwara pick up a lot of sacks lately, gets there in the backfield for the loss of five, and that brings up another punting situation for Alex Howell and Notre Dame, as Howell stands just off his goal line, out to pick up some pretty good field position here. Not a great punt by Howell as Sanders comes up to the 49-yard line where Notre Dame will begin its latest series. 3:42 left in the opening quarter at Fenway Park for Notre Dame. And the green-clad Fighting Irish have a 3-0 lead. Tomorrow, 1:30 Eastern, Jeff Gordon races to go out on top with a fifth championship at the Ford EcoBoost 400 in Miami. So it's a race to the finish here for the NASCAR Sprint Cup Series Championship on NBC. Those are the final four drivers who have a chance. There's the sentimental pick, Jeff Gordon, Kevin Harvick, Kyle Busch, and Martin Truex Jr., who stay alive to go out on top of the NASCAR Sprint Cup Series Championship. Notre Dame at its own 49-yard line begins here in this series with Kosice, and he picks up more huge yardage all the way down to the 30. The ball comes loose. Justin Simmons was over there who stripped it out for the Eagles. No indication yet by the officials.
It was Simmons in there ripping at the ball. He got it out. I believe this ball is out. Right at the end of the run, 27 Simmons just rips at the ball before they go to the ground. And that ball is out. This Boston College defense has been opportunistic, continues to scrap and claw. Notre Dame has looked very good offensively, been able to move the ball up and down the field. But right now, they only have 3 points to show for it. They've made some big plays, but turnovers are hurting them.
Second turnover of the game, could have been three besides the one that got overturned on the video. And so Boston College sets up at its own 32. And Fadul hands it off, and getting two or three hard-earned yards is Tyler Rouse. Okwara up there up front put the grip on it.
Where Joe Schmidt closed that down from the backside to make a play, but he just ran through the tackle. Physical runners for Boston College, they're happy if they can pick up 3 or 4 yards. If they can hammer the football, keeping good down the distance, they feel they have a shot to work the clock and move the sticks.
On the ground again, scratching and clawing his way across the 35 is Rouse.
Rouse, great run, slips through some arm tackle, and still picks up positive yards. I do not believe the offensive line of Boston College blocked a single guy on that play. I honestly think there were four guys penetrating right through, and Rouse ran through a couple arms and made something out of it. Like I said, to keep down in distance. If you can stay in third and five or less, you have an opportunity to do your quarterback run game or quick passing game.
So third and five. Fadul feels pressure from the backside and just gets rid of it. He's looking for David Dudek, but that'll bring up another punting situation for BC.
Notre Dame's bringing pressure. They're slanting the line and bringing people off the edge, but this is an easy pass protection for Boston College. They just do a turn slide protection, and it's kind of zoning it off and taking the man that comes your way. Gives Fadul an opportunity to get the ball out, but no one was open, and he sails the ball out of bounds.
So it'll be the third punt for Alex Howell, who will then be just one punt away from breaking the school record for most in a season. If you watched us last week, oh, it's a fake, and up front, short of the first down. Now the ball's loose. And Notre Dame recovers it right there.
I like the play call. I like the aggressiveness, and it's really close to hitting. There was a crease, but it was Matthias Farley making the tackle.
That was Justin Simmons who had the ball on the fake punt. And then he loses the handle. And so when we come back, it'll be Irish football at the Boston College 40. Beautiful night, city of Boston, Fenway Park, all dressed up for a football game between the Notre Dame Fighting Irish and Boston College Eagles. In an interesting matchup when you even get further inside the numbers, that Boston College defense, number one ranked in the country, the potent Notre Dame offense, even though they were held to a season low last week. But right now, total yards department, Notre Dame leads 125 to Boston College's 26. As Notre Dame looking to add to its 3-0 lead, already with two turnovers. Let's see if they can keep it clean here. C.J. Procise with a nice pirouette spin move. Picks up the first down, the ball's on the turf again, and Notre Dame got it back. But some sloppy ball handling here by the Irish. As Procise loses the handle again.
It's a play-action pass, and Procise is just going to slip through. Great job by Kaiser deciding not to force it up the field, just dumps it off. C.J. Procise has to hold on the ball. Boston College is stripping at the ball on every opportunity they get.
That was John Johnson, number 9, just stripping it out of Procise's arms, and Nick Martin recovering it for Notre Dame. So it's a new running back in there, and Josh Adams gets his first call of the game. It was right. Adams who had that huge 98-yard run for a touchdown last week against Wake Forest, filling in for Procise, who was out with concussion-like symptoms.
Brian Kelly will not put up with carelessness with the football. He's teaching C.J. Procise a lesson right now. I know Boston College is stripping at the ball, making it happen, but you have to focus on hanging on to the football.
So a loss of 3 for Adams in his first carry, and really, if you look at Adams last week, he averaged about 2 yards a carry outside of that 98-yard touchdown run, which is the longest in Notre Dame history. Kaiser going to the end zone, and there's not much room out there from the end zone line to the wall, especially in those corners of the end zone, as Kaiser was looking for Alizé Jones.
Really, Kaiser was holding on to the ball and looking for something. It really wasn't there. He was hoping Jones would outrun the coverage, and he went for it late. Excellent pass protection. Finally had to give up on the play and throw it long.
3rd and 13. Kaiser with plenty of time goes across the middle, and that was a dangerous pass. Intended for Will Fuller. And it was Matt Milano who was out there who looked like he might have had a chance to pick that one off.
Milano did a great job of turning and finding the ball. I thought Kaiser was going to go deep down the middle, but Milano's body language, he turned and broke to the inside. Where Kaiser was anticipating Fuller coming around Milano, Milano did a great job of turning back to the middle of the field, almost comes up with the interception.
So Justin Yoon, who connected earlier from 30, will now attempt a 44-yarder to give the Irish a 6-0 lead. Kaiser on the hold, sets it down, and a flag is down as the kick was no good, but ran into Yoon. Believe that was John Johnson.
Personal foul, roughing the kicker on the defense, number 9, 15-yard penalty. Correction, half the distance to the goal, automatic first down.
Huge penalty on Johnson, the guy that picked up the key interception earlier.
That is killer. He lays out thinking he has a real opportunity for that ball, and he was close. But if you're not touching the football, you cannot touch the kicker. And if the personal foul creates a first down situation,
Boston College almost got away with, still Notre Dame offensively has moved the ball very well and only has 3 points on the board and shouldn't have this opportunity.
So here's Kaiser with a 1st and 10 from the Boston College 13. And he gives it up the middle, and there's Josh Adams again. He gets it inside the 10. Harold Landry, the talented sophomore defensive end, on the stop for the Eagles.
Now Josh Adams is every bit as explosive as C.J. Procise if he gets a chance in the open field. Both these guys are breakaway speed.
So Procise still continuing to watch from the bench, and I'm here. Carlisle's on a big night, and it just got bigger. Touchdown, Notre Dame. Touchdown of the year for Carlisle.
Carlisle catches the ball, but watch the block Corey Robinson gets, which creates space for Carlisle to make Harris miss and get in the end zone. Corey Robinson seals to the inside, leaves Harris out in space, and Carlisle makes a miss.
Carlisle with his 4th catch of the game. No other Irish receiver has more than one. Justin Yoon comes on to tack on the extra point. Just gets it inside that right upright to make it a 10-0 Notre Dame lead with just 4 seconds left in the opening quarter. So just a week after Notre Dame on offense, Doug, turned in its lowest point total or its lowest yardage of the year. They've been racking up some yardage here against Boston College, but turnovers have hurt both teams, and the Irish up on top with Yoon's field goal, 10-0.
Very fortunate to come away with a touchdown for Notre Dame there. I tell you what, the Boston College defense is playing scrappy. They're not shutting down Notre Dame in any way. They are moving the football. Notre Dame on offense looks very polished to me right now in the running game. They're missing on the pass game because it's tough. Tight man-to-man coverage, throws are tough. You've got to make a perfect throw, but they're going to, those big plays are going to come if they keep slinging it
down
the field.
You think we can move into your seats down there and your baseball seats just below us? You're a little better seats than we got here.
It's not too far. We can go down there. I mean, we just get there right by Canvas Alley. I caught a line drive in the Yankees game over there, get a foul ball. It's my spot. My buddy Al Seymour and I hang out there all the time.
Not a lot of bad spots at Fenway Park. Tyler Newsom puts it into play towards Boston College's Michael Walker. He brings this one out across the 20 and across to the 25-yard line, where the Eagles will begin trailing 10-0 as we've reached the end of the first quarter at Fenway. We'll be right back to Fenway Park after these messages. You're watching Notre Dame football on NBCSN. Another gorgeous shot of the city of Boston. Dan Hicks, Doug Flutie, Catherine Tappan with you from Fenway Park, oldest park in Major League Baseball. Opened up 103 years ago. Reserved for a college football game tonight. Boston College at the start of the second quarter begins on the ground with Miles Willis, who gets his first carry of the game. Joe Schmidt on the stop for the Irish.
Again, a good first down, positive run for Boston College, but they're not converting on the third downs.
Fadul and Boston College with a little more of a hurry-up look here. Well, check that. He's looking to the sideline now. With Miles Willis still in there behind him. With a shortish running back at just 5'9". And Fadul gives him another chance, and right in the backfield was Jalen Smith flying through, saying, no way.
Jalen Smith diagnosed this right away and just runs through. Watch him on the weak side linebacker come just downhill right now, meets the back 2 yards deep in the backfield. There's no hesitation. Just reading a play, knowing where it's going, and just being confident in what you're seeing, trusting your eyes and going.
Every offensive coordinator we talk to this year, we say, what's the key? Well, we got Jalen Smith, man. That number 9 is some linebacker. Everybody knows who he is. And now Fadul going to the air, and this one was caught and then dropped by Elijah Robinson. The freshman had it, for just a second. Cole Luke was on the coverage. It'll bring up fourth and six.
Great route, creates separation. Cole Luke is off in coverage. The ball takes a little bit to get there, but he should catch this ball and hold on. He's a former quarterback playing wide receiver. Phenomenal athlete in Robinson, but he's just not a polished receiver. Hold on to the football, tuck it away. As soon as you catch it, you have to tuck it.
So Alex Howell on for another punt, and this one is off the side of his foot and just kind of drops at the 42-yard line. So the Irish will take over from there with 13:30 left in the half. Let's go down to Catherine.
Well, Dan, I talked to you at the top of the show about the 10 yards between the 45 and the 45 being the neutral territory for these two teams. And Notre Dame's coaching staff is getting very annoyed with the signal calling screens for the BC Eagles. They are coming into that neutral territory, and it's clogging that area up and causing some communication issues on the behalf of Notre Dame. So it's getting a little chippy down here. So I'm just going to stay tight in between the two.
Get yourself a screen tap and just put up your own line of defense.
Put the shields up.
C.J. Procise, after mishandling the ball tonight, is back there on the beginning of this series for Deshaun Kizer in Notre Dame. And Procise working on the right edge, and a nice open field tackle there by Matt Milano, who BC defensive coordinator Donnie Brown calls a TFL machine, tackle for loss guy.
Again, it's the same thing I said about Jalen Smith. He just reacted up right away, fought through a block by Torrey Hunter. It's being committed to, you don't want to slow down at contact. You don't want to slow down. You want to be aggressive and make the back avoid you at full speed.
So the loss of three, second and 13. DC showing more pressure from the edge, and here comes Milano again, and he just nails Kizer right after Kizer gave it away. That was Strahan coming in there. Procise had the ball, but they just blew that one up.
You think they had this defended? Strahan and the quarterback. I'm going to hit my guy before you. Boom!
That is an exact sink there.
They had it covered. That's option football, and everyone doing their job. Take your responsibility.
Strahan and Milano blowing it up now. Third and 18. Again, top unit in the country defensively. In total defense and rushing yards allowed. And Kizer steps up. Just looking for somebody, but he's closed in on, and that'll bring up the punting unit for Notre Dame. Pretty impressive showing there for BC's D.
Coverage is very confusing. I mean, he really doesn't have pressure. He's looking. He can't find an open receiver. Actually, Will Fuller, really late, was coming across the field. But even I'm trying to decipher who's getting double-teamed down the field and who isn't. And Kizer's eyes are all over the place trying to find that singled-up guy, and he can't find him.
And this is a booming punt by Newsom. It just stops there at the six, and nicely done. Beautiful special teams orchestrated there. Matthias Farley downs it deep, and Newsom comes all the way down to the end of the field to congratulate him, as Boston College will begin deep in its own territory when we return. Notre Dame football on NBCSN is brought to you by Gatorade. Knows it all begins within. Win from within. By Goodyear, tires with a strong tradition of superior performance. By the Discover It card, the card that treats you like you treat you. And by United, fly the friendly skies. All sorts of events through the years here at Fenway Park, including a little ice hockey by Notre Dame and Boston College recently. Football, the sport du jour on this Saturday. And Boston College backed up at its 6-yard line after that booming punt by Newsom. And that's going to bring up second down and 9 or so, as Miles Willis gets something out of it. Before that, in 4 possessions, just 30 yards for the Eagles, Doug, with just 1 first down. As you look at the screening controversy continuing on the sideline.
It's going to be the game within the game on the sideline, and coaches yelling at each other. And it really doesn't matter. You're not stealing each other's signals. You're not going to see the play calls.
Notre Dame looking to keep BC deep down on this part of the field to get excellent field position, perhaps, if they can force a punt. Second down and 8. That pass is complete. Just short of the first down is Thad Smith. And we were talking before the game, Doug, Thad Smith might be the best all-around guy that Fadul has tonight.
I really think he's the most talented receiver skill-wise as far as catching the ball, being able to play the ball in the air, route running. Did a nice job of breaking a tackle there, getting the first down. I mean, they need to move the chain, especially when you're backed up in your own end. Boston College needed a first down. It's been a while.
Thad Smith was on the sidelines, and he just hustled back out to the edge there, right in front of his own bench, as they pick up the first down. And this is Miles Willis again. And a little positive mojo going now here for this much maligned BC offense.
John Baker pulled out the center. They're not making a lot of blocks up front. The backs are splitting defenders and making it happen. I mean, 77 big comes out. He misses two guys, but Willis makes a miss.
There's John Baker, who Todd Fitch, the offensive coordinator, calls the bell cow of this Boston College offensive line. That's Willis again. Bring up third down and 4.
As long as you can get a hat on a hat up front, you're giving your back a chance. When you're turning people free with penetration, he doesn't have a chance. Another big third down conversion.
He's got Miles Willis still in there to his left.
Sheldon Day is standing up on the outside on the right side of the formation in two-point stance. He's a pass rusher.
And the walk-on freshman quarterback, John Fadul, has to sneak out of this one, and he does. Fadul gets the first down before he's finally chased out by Jalen Smith. Gain of 18 for Fadul.
Here comes the pressure off the outside edge. Getting after it. Fadul does a great job of stepping up, seeing a crease and going. He's, you know, it's not going to be polished. He's a young quarterback, but if he can make plays and move the chains, he keeps Boston College alive.
Well, on the move to the right side here is the give, maybe a yard, by Sherman Alston. And if you thought Rouse and Willis were short, Alston is 5'6", 163 pound sophomore from Harlem.
You got a problem with that?
No, I don't.
Okay.
We're just pointing out the facts. Second down and 10. Alston gets nothing, and back on the ground they go to Tyler Rouse, who gets a couple.
Not real flashy play calling. First and 10, a lot of runs up inside, run the ball, the jet sweep. Boston College does not want to outthink themselves and make mistakes. They want to try to stay in down and distance, give their young quarterback a chance to convert, not put him in too many pressure situations. But because of the negative yardage on first down, it's third and long. He's going to have to throw the ball.
Ball is just on the outside of the infield. Now sodded over. You can see that line that swoops in there at the 41-yard line. And on third and 7, Fadul feels the pressure, and he is overcome at the 30 by a number of Notre Dame defenders. That was Max Redfield flashing in there.
Just
Joe Schmidt and company as well.
Total overload blitz. Bring the house. Joe Schmidt comes from the outside up top, and he is the unblocked guy. Furthest away, as a quarterback, especially a young quarterback, a lot of times you want to just move and run away from the blitz. Your best defense of the blitz is set your foot and get rid of the ball, give your receiver a shot, or throw it away.
Second sack on Fadul results in the loss of 10. And so that now brings out Alex Howell again. This is an excellent high hanging punt that drives Sanders back to the 20, and then he has to let it go, and then he grabs it again.
Oh, fair catch though. He had called originally for the fair catch. He cannot advance the ball. That'll be a delay game.
So the official there marking it at about the 14-yard line, 15-yard line. Make it.
Right at the end of the play, though, after the ball bounces around, he called the fair catch. He goes after it.
Delay a game on the return team. Number 9 running with the ball after giving it fair catch signal. First down. Timeout.
Justin Simmons, number 27, does a great job. He saw the fair catch, and then even if he's going to run with the ball, 27 Simmons pulls off, which instinctively is against everything you usually would do.
Can't advance it, so they pull the flag on Sanders, and we'll be back to Fenway with the Irish up 10-0. Top performances as we take you back all the way to the 1983 Liberty Bowl. Who is that guy, 22?
He's too small to play. I don't know.
28-yarder to Gerard Phelan. Who's he? The Eagles were down 19-12 at the half, and then you hit your tight end, Scott Gieselman, for a 3-yarder in the third, and you had one final chance, but that Irish blitz forced your incompletion there, Doug, and Notre Dame held on for the one-point win despite the loss. You were the game MVP. That is our Mercedes-Benz top performances.
6 touchdowns scored, 1 extra point made. It was a field of ice.
And there is the Boston College band watching as Notre Dame takes over on offense. And a nice dart there thrown and complete to Chris Brown, who hauls in his first catch of the game.
Nice job of pass protection, allows Chris Brown to work up the field. Good job putting your foot in the ground and getting over the middle of the field. That's a downfield route where Kaiser just took his time, held on to the ball, and waited for his receiver to break open.
So the first down strike to Brown. Closing in on the 6-minute mark of the opening half. Kaiser now with a give up the middle, and this is Procise. Got maybe one.
That interior of the Boston College line is tough. Wojak throws his man to the side and makes a play. It's tough sledding up inside. I think what we saw early in the game from Notre Dame and spreading the Boston College defense out is their best opportunity to run the football.
Well, Don Brown, the defensive coordinator for the Eagles, as Procise is on the ground. So the clock with 5:56 and a second down and 8. Take another look, see if we can pick up what happened to Procise. Kind of sandwiched there and thrown to the ground on the back of his head. Try to get an update on Procise when we come back. Notre Dame's leading rusher, C.J. Procise, being tended to on the sideline, and you can tell here, Doug, that his ankle got wrapped up underneath the body of Connor Wojak, number 90 there. And so Procise steps off. And on second down and 8, Kaiser goes across the middle, and it's complete for a first down to Chris Brown. Big gain for Brown on another catch. That one good for 18.
Wow, what a laser. He threw that one in there. He had a tight window because not only is the corner running with him, he's got Harris as a free defender in the middle of the field, and he's got to get it to him before he reaches Harris, and Harris is breaking on him to get the hit after the catch, but great timing on the throw.
So Kaiser is already over his passing yardage total of all the whole game against Wake Forest. This is Josh Adams trying to look for a hole on the right side, in there for Procise.
What did Don Brown say about his defensive line? War daddies?
Because we got some war daddies down there. He's proud of him, and there's Procise still being looked at. There is Donnie Brown, born in Massachusetts. If you had a Massachusetts coach at a central casting, he'd be Don Brown. Second and 13, Kaiser throws it behind Hunter, who had to come around, so incomplete. John Johnson on the coverage in the BC secondary.
Finally get a zone look out of the Boston College defense, and they just sat back way off and break on the throw. Nice job. The ball's a little behind Torrey Hunter, but the reason it's behind him, because if he had let him, there was an opportunity for an interception.
So third and 13 now for Kaiser. Notre Dame, 2+ touchdown favorites in this game, up 10-0 with 5 minutes left in the first half. Kaiser with an empty backfield. Thrown over the top, incomplete. It was intended for Corey Robinson, and it got loose there. The ball did there for a second. It was up for grabs, but another punt up coming here for Brian Kelly's offense.
That was a legitimate pick play in the middle of the field. I still don't think it would have run out the gate the way you would like for pick. Well, the ball's out in front of him. He might take it running a little bit as Harris is trailing, but Harris was trailing because defenders got picked. Notre Dame was very fortunate not to get a call off of that.
Tyler Newsom with a beauty on his last punt. And this is a rocket. And it goes off the hands of Sherman Alston, And he's had a tendency to muff some punts for Boston College as it's deep down there inside the five of the Eagles.
I can hear my nephew yelling in my ear. He's dropped six balls this year, three big turnovers. He's costing. Sherman Austin is an athletic kid down there, and he can make plays in the punt return, but he has had trouble this year securing the football.
So you're saying the Fluties have watched a few BC games?
Yes, you think? I get my scouting report from my nephews. They know more than I do on these guys.
Yes, and Notre Dame takes over on the muff punt by Sherman Alston. First and goal, Irish.
It's really a matter if he's misjudging the ball in the air and gets in a bad position. You want to catch a punt in front of you with your hands underneath the ball. He's reaching up for it at his shoulder, primarily because the punt carried on him and got deep.
Look at the ball. I mean, two Irish jerseys went right by it. It was underneath still the legs loose of a Boston College Eagle and was still loose. Before Scott Daly, I think the long snapper, number 61, recovered it. And so Adazio is fuming over another setback here. And Tyler Newsom is having himself quite a night. Another booming punt. Notre Dame takes over. At the four. Kaiser gives it up the middle and driving down close to the 2 yard line is Josh Adams, with Procise still on the sideline. Truman Goodapple on the stop, and there is Procise now limping to the locker room. Again, a couple of games ago, suffered a concussion late in the first quarter, sat out last week's game against Wake Forest, and now, with about 4 minutes left here in the opening half, Procise headed to the locker room. Second and goal. Adams down to the one. Third and goal. Justin Simmons prevented him from getting in.
Really get the impression that Brian Kelly doesn't want to take any risk here, wants to hammer the ball and just stick it in the end zone without having to get fancy, because he does not want another turnover. Notre Dame has been careless with the football, especially in the red zone so far today. They need to come away with 7 points out of this.
Wrapped up for a loss of one on the ball, a strip, and Boston College has it. And that's Matt Milano with a recovery. Another turnover for Notre Dame.
Connor Strahan was the guy that penetrated and made the great hit. Milano rips at the ball after Strahan, 13 in the middle. Strahan comes right from there, busts through, makes the hit, and Milano from the backside rips at the ball and pulls it out. This could have been 7 points the other way.
So Procise, who just walked off the field, has had a hard time holding on to it. Adams has it stripped. Milano recovers, and Notre Dame with three turnovers tonight, all of them in the red zone, keeping Boston College in it. High above Fenway Park as Boston College off another Notre Dame turnover has the ball at its own 16-yard line. Procise making his way into the locker room, injured his ankle. He's added to the turnover total, and so did Josh Adams just a moment ago with Notre Dame on the doorstep inside the Eagle one. So now Boston College at its own 16 with 3:25 left. Try to get on the board before the half, and they find Tommy Sweeney for a big game. The first catch for Sweeney, the big tight end for Padul, 6'5", 246-pounder, brought down by Elijah Shoemate, but not before a gain of 22.
Linebackers and safety all step up on the play action. Wide open to Sweeney. He's made an appearance the last couple of weeks. He's starting to come alive. A big, big target down the middle of the field, Sweeney.
Redshirt freshman from Ramsey, New Jersey, with his fifth catch of the year. And Padul going all the way downfield, and this one should have been caught by Thad Smith. He had it, and he had 6 points as well if he was able to hang on.
So the young quarterback gets a little confidence, heads a big play, comes right back, and Thad Smith blows by Cole Luke,
Beautiful throw. Steps into the throw, John Fadul does. Look at the cushion close and run right by. Now just catch the ball. You can't put it any better. Catch the football. Boston College could have been in this game. They haven't moved the ball on offense. When you have an opportunity to make a big play, you got to come up with it.
Fadul knows that would have been a game of 40 to Smith. Instead, it's second down and 10, and he'll go to the air again. Now he's got to run from pressure, and now he just throws it away, third and 10.
But boy, Boston College had an opportunity to gain a little momentum there. They've made one big play and got out of their own end. They've done nothing on offense all day. Now all of a sudden you feel confident, coach wants to take a shot, you call the shot play, you have it, and it doesn't happen for you.
Last ranked offense in the country has 77 total yards right now to Notre Dame's 180, but three turnovers by the Irish, keeping the Eagles right there, and Adazio is down just 10-0.
It really should be a 28-0 game, and Boston College is right in it.
Here's Fadul, feels the pressure, gets rid of it, it's complete to David Dudek. Short of the first down, bring up fourth down. Elijah Shoemate saved him from getting to the sticks.
All out pressure. I like the job Fadul does of just giving ground because he knows he has a crossing route and gets the ball, but a great, great tackle by Elijah Shoemate. One-on-one in open field. If Dudek could somehow step out of that tackle, he may be gone. Shoemate, excellent tackle, wrap up, pull the man to the ground short of the first down.
By a ways, fourth and six for Boston College, which is huddling over there on the sidelines. C.J. Sanders has made his way back to his 22-yard line. As Alex Howell picks up the low snap, and this is a poor punt to the right. Takes a bit of a BC bounce. And Notre Dame will take over with 1:51 left at its own 27. Shamrock Series from Fenway Park. High above Fenway, aerial coverage provided by Goodyear. Whether you drive 100 yards or 100 miles, choose Goodyear tires for superior performances. Goodyear, more driven. 1:51 left in the opening half. As we remind you that the Discover Card halftime report is coming your way in just a bit. Jimmy Roberts in the studio. He'll have all the scores and highlights from another big day and night in college football. How about that Ohio State-Michigan State ending? And there is Liam, Jonathan Vilma over there on the left, and Hines Ward ready to wrap up the whole day. He's shielding Liam from his halftime thoughts. Deep downfield goes the pass to Chris Brown, incomplete, as Kaiser went deep to the whiteout.
McCleary was running with him up the seam, and stride for stride, it was actually a perfect throw, but a very difficult catch. Great coverage and one-on-one. Running with him, the ball's in a good spot. Got a hand in there, McCleary got a hand in there, knocked it loose. Chris Brown could not come up with it.
So it's a little bit like last week against Wake Forest. Here we are, Doug, in deep into the first half, and Will Fuller doesn't have a single reception. Carlisle, Brown, Procise, and Torrey Hunter Jr., the only guys to connect with Kaiser so far. Kaiser on a designed run play, and this is what he can do. Underrated, really, as a runner.
And I even undersold him early in the year as his running ability. We've seen him bust long runs. We've seen him run in short yardage situations. And when you start calling the quarterback runs right now, Brian Kelly's saying, the heck with it. We need to score points no matter what. We're going to call whatever is necessary.
Kaiser sprints for 15 and brings the ball up to the 42-yard line with a minute 24 left. And now he goes to the air, and that one should have been caught probably by Chris Brown.
Might have been a little in front of Brown, but boy, Kaiser steps into his throw and turns it loose. Chris Brown coming in the middle had to reach a little bit of a tough catch because the ball was thrown so firmly, but boy, he steps into a throw. Down and away, just a touch.
So that brings up second down and 10. Corey Robinson is now into the Irish lineup. Kaiser's got time. Avoids one Eagle and then just throws it away. third and 10. This Boston College defense has been all over the field so far, Doug.
You know, Notre Dame's been able to move the ball, but this defense has been opportunistic. A bad mistake here, bad decision. Take advantage of then raking at the ball. They reach in on every opportunity and do the old lawnmower motion. Start the lawnmower, pull it out. Notre Dame's very fortunate. They got a couple of fumbles back. But Boston College still scrapping, even with the short field, no points for Notre Dame.
Two of the three turnovers really in the red zone, because one in the red zone was overturned, so ProSize has lost the handle a couple of times, really just one time officially with the one that was turned around, and then Adams with the fumble, and then the interception that Kizer threw earlier. On third and 10, going deep downfield, and he just puts it up for grabs, and it's picked off by Justin Simmons.
Pressure by Daniels, and the ball's thrown up for grabs down the middle of the field. I'm sure Kizer thought there was nothing in the middle of the field, and I'm gonna give my guy a shot. 52 in the middle, Daniels right through. Great move, gets pressure on the quarterback. Kizer decides, I'm gonna put this up and let my receiver make a play because there's no one in the middle of the field. But on the backside, Simmons reacts to the ball, comes across, secures the catch.
So the pick by Boston College, the second of the game on Kizer. So two interceptions, two fumbles by Notre Dame. And really it's like a short punt as it gets back into Boston College's hands. Padul has the ball deflected, as the Eagles have all three of their timeouts with a minute left.
Coach wants them to take off and run. And in an offense, when things are going really good, yeah, pull up and look down the field. Look down the field and maybe make a big play. But here he had an opportunity to run for 5 to 10 yards.
And there
and
is.
Yeah, still got that eyes downfield, real close to the line of scrimmage, but I think he got rid of it in time. But he was looking to make a bigger play.
Yeah, full body has to be across the line of scrimmage. So Padul is okay there. He finds Rouse out of the backfield. He gets close to the first down. 50 seconds and counting as Kizer is getting a talking to by Kelly.
Boy, plenty of timeouts. I would use, anytime you don't make a first down in college football, call your timeout.
Boston College at its own 40, trailing 10 to nothing. Third and short, Padul bring up fourth and short as he wanted Dudek.
Fourth and short, your own end of the field, you have to punt it away. You haven't done anything on offense, so even if you convert, there's no guarantee you would continue down the field and score points, and you do not want to give Notre Dame an opportunity to get points before the half. And a lot of times that goes into Adazio's thinking in letting the clock run occasionally, because he's not real sure that they're going to convert that third down, and he doesn't want to be giving the ball back to the opposition because the offense has been a little shaky.
Yeah, not a lot of reasons to have any kind of confidence in your offense. And sliding and losing it for a second there was Sanders. Boy, it's been somewhat of a
the punt game's been fun today.
CJ Sanders losing it for a second there with 27 seconds left. Well, tomorrow morning, Premier League returns. This season's Giant Slayers look to strike again as West Ham heads to White Hart Lane to face Tottenham. The Premier League weekend continues tomorrow morning at 10 Eastern time right here on NBC SN. Well, they've been playing football here since Fenway Park opened back in 1912. In fact, Boston College has played over 100 football games here through the years.
Sir.
You've had high school teams play here, professional teams play here, but again, the first time in almost 50 years that there's been a football game of any kind here.
The depressing part of that was the last game Boston College played here was against in-state rival Holy Cross, a very bitter rivalry back in those days, and BC lost 7-0.
Well, this bitter rivalry continues between Notre Dame and Boston College, and Notre Dame will head to the locker room with a 10-0 lead as the final seconds tick off the second quarter. Four turnovers by the Irish as they head to the locker room to talk things over. We send you down to Catherine.
Coach, four turnovers, three in BC's territory in the first half. What do you tell your team in terms of ball protection here?
Well, they know how to hold on to the football. Just sloppy, and that's why it's a 10-0 game at halftime.
Any update on CJ Procise? We saw his left ankle getting worked on.
Yeah, I went in for an x-ray. We'll find out when we get in.
It seems like it's a little chippy in the conversations between the two coaching staffs on the sideline. Any distractions on there?
No, I don't think so. I mean, you might have a couple of graduate assistants that, you know, we're talking about how much money they make, but other than that, I don't think there's much going on.
Coach, thank you. Dan?
Brian Kelly, even with four turnovers, figures out a little bit of humor to take he and the Irish to that quaint Boston Red Sox locker room. Well, they will talk things over. Discover Card halftime report comes your way. Now let's go to Jimmy Roberts in our NBC studio with the Irish up 10 to nothing.
I think it's going to be something special when we come out to Fenway.
And at Fenway Park, here come the Irish.
At this point in the season, you throw the records out.
Rolling to his right, and that is picked off.
They're going to bring their A game. We're going to have to bring our very best.
He makes it eight straight with that 30-yarder for Justin Yoon. Carlisle's had a big night, and it just got bigger. Touchdown, Notre Dame. The ball is stripped. Another turnover for Notre Dame.
This game right here is everything to us.
Dame clinging to a 10-0 lead as we take a look at the first half stats and what stands out of those four turnovers by Notre Dame. Two fumbles, two interceptions, two of the turnovers in the red zone, including a Josh Adams fumble on third and goal inside the Boston College one. So the Eagles get their hands on the football first, and this is a huge return by Michael Walker. Drag, oh no, they still don't have him. Finally spun out of bounds.
Boy, Walker came alive against NC State with kickoff returns, and recently he has been making big plays on the kick return or really close to going all the way. And here, great blocking up front. He has excellent speed, shakes. He's not giving up on this. He knows he's got an opportunity here, and he is trying to take it all the way. Just the second part of the season, he's been getting his hands on the ball on kick returns, and it's making the most of his opportunities.
That is a 67-yard return by the true freshman up at Naples, Florida. Moved from wide receiver to the defensive side of the football. He was recruited as an athlete, and boy, he just showed some athleticism with that romp, which opens up the second half. A duel on the ground here, and that is for maybe a loss of a yard by Miles Willis. Down to Catherine.
Well, Dan, I spoke to Boston College head coach Steve Adazio at halftime, and he said that he thought his defense has been extremely resilient in this game. Offensively, he said it's the same problems we've been having all season long. We're shooting ourselves in the foot. We've got a really young team, but he said we're going to play hard this half. We're going to play as if we're going out. We want to win this game. Some injury updates for Notre Dame. CJ Procise, left ankle injury. He is out. Cole Luke, left arm. It was just a funny bone issue. He is back in the game, guys.
And Fadul this time gets a little more, maybe a yard or two, but that is it. It'll bring up third and long as Jalen Smith wraps up Willis.
Third and long situation. Right now it'd be about a 43-yard field goal, and the BC field goal kicking situation has not been real solid.
That's an understatement.
It could be four down territory.
Boston College has used three different field goal kickers this year. The latest is Mike Knoll. As we now stand at third and eight, Adazio doesn't even want to bring anybody out. He wants to keep this drive alive and try to punch it in and really throw a scare into Notre Dame's fans across the world watching this one from Fenway Park. Boston College with a huge kickoff return to start, and the play clock getting down there, and a flag comes in.
There was movement on the offensive line.
Timeout. Boston College.
All right.
Go first.
Just ahead of the play clock.
The Notre Dame defense realized the play clock was running down and tried to time the blitz with the play clock, and there was a little bit of jumping around going on up front. But evidently, Adazio called the timeout in time to avoid a penalty.
As you look at Kelly and Adazio in his third year, Kelly in his sixth year, looking to push the Irish record to 10-1. But again, the first football game of any kind played here at Fenway Park since 1968. Boston College really outrun here by the Irish fans, a little more than 37,000 here. capacity at Fenway Park, and Boston College had access to only 5,000 of those 37,000 plus tickets, but that's standard for ACC teams on the road.
You know, you're on the road. It's so hard for the Boston fans to realize this is a road game for Boston College. Tickets in the Boston area and for Boston College fans were very difficult to come by.
So a big play coming up here for Padul on 3rd and 8 from the Irish 25.
Again, potential four down territory.
Padul surveying the middle of the field, and it is in and out of the arms of Charlie Callinan. He had a chance at it.
Boy, that was a tight window, though. Callahan did have a shot at this. Padul makes up his mind, I'm going right there. Joe Schmidt almost gets a finger on it, not quite, but boy, it was a tight window. Fourth down, they will attempt the field goal.
So in field goal formation here, and this is again one of three that have had field goal attempts here for Boston College. This is Colton Lichtenberg, who hasn't kicked in quite some time. They put it down for a 43-yard attempt, and Lichtenberg is through the uprights. He kicked earlier in the season. He missed some crucial field goals in the Wake Forest game. He missed from 31 and 26 when Boston College lost to Wake Forest in that 3-0 game. But he gets the duties here tonight, and it wasn't the smoothest operation, but they put it down for him. Alex Howell does, and Lichtenberg pulls Adazio a little closer. Notre Dame football on NBCSN is brought to you by GE, the digital company that's also an industrial company, by Cadillac, by Kellogg's Rice Krispies cereal, and by U.S. Bank. Cool scene here with the Boston Pops. Many of the Notre Dame fans a part of that celebration. Lots of celebrations around the Boston area around this game.
It was really odd being in the hotel, though, with all Notre Dame fans in the center of Boston, right down the street from a Boston College football game.
Notre Dame leading, taking over, leading the series 13-9. They've won the last four, but Boston College staying in this one as Lichtenberg kicks it towards C.J. Sanders, who bobbles it and then gets on his feet and turns it into a pretty good return. Still on his feet, tried to cross and finally dragged down at about the 28-yard line.
Boy, Milano was ripping at the ball again. Great return by Simon.
So again, it's been 47 years since the last football game was played here at Fenway Park. The Boston Patriots, now the New England squad, called Fenway Park home for six seasons in the mid-60s. Their final game at Fenway played on December 1st, 68, against the Bengals. The game ended 33-14 in the Patriots' favor, and it was the last time a football game has been played at the Red Sox home field. Overall, the Patriots played 38 games here at Fenway Park. And so the latest version here of college football, Josh Adams around the corner for some good yardage for Notre Dame. Speaking of the Patriots, look who's in attendance. New England Patriots head coach Bill Belichick with the Patriots set to take on the Buffalo Bills. Couple of teams you play for.
I don't know who to root for in those games anymore. I played for just about everybody. That was Linda Holiday, Bill's girlfriend with him.
Belichick, good friends with Notre Dame head football coach Brian Kelly. And on 1st and 10, Deshaun Kizer, who told Brian Kelly that he was going to be a Notre Dame football player with Belichick in the same room with Kelly. Kizer going deep downfield, incomplete. And he was looking for Chris Brown. In fact, Tom Brady was also in that New England team room when Kizer made the call to Kelly. Here's another look at the Brown route.
John Johnson keeps a hand on him, runs stride for stride with him. Great coverage on the play. Chris Brown hand fighting a little bit. the big play, you would expect offensively for Notre Dame to make a big play eventually. You're going to take your shots. If they're going to play man-to-man coverage, Notre Dame has the athletes to make the big play on the outside, and they're going to hit one of these shots.
Still no catch for Fuller. And he's split down to the bottom of the screen here to the near side. Play clock getting down, and Kaiser finally calling for it and gets it. Steps up, pressure, throwing it downfield, just heaving it Brown's way. And Brown came up with it. John Johnson was on the coverage, but what a catch by Brown.
What a throw. And in the pocket, he doesn't have anything right away. Gets a little bit of great job of sliding, moving. Step up, under and out. Now he keeps his eyes up the field, and it was his only option. I thought he was throwing the ball away. Chris Brown keeps working for him, goes back to the corner. There wasn't much room for error, and just a phenomenal throw and catch.
Play is under further review.
And they're taking another look at this one, which for the moment is a 38-yard toss from Kaiser to Brown.
He's in bounds. It's just a matter of whether he's controlling the football the entire time, and it appears he did. Does he? Does he maintain? He's on the ground. Now a rip at the ball and maybe adjust it. That's a catch.
Well, let's bring in Doug Rhodes, who's been with us all season, former supervising of officiating for the ACC. Doug, what do you see here?
Well, the process of the catch we always talk about. Possess it, get a body part down in bounds. There's stage two. And then maintain it when he goes to the ground. Survive contact with the ground, and I think he does.
And again, since it's ruled on the field a catch, it takes that.
You would really have to see that ball move.
Indisputable evidence to turn it around. Here's the call.
After further review, the ruling on the field stands. First down.
You know, and he said stands. So that means there was a little indication that ball moved a little bit, but it's a catch.
So the 38-yard gain by Brown is good. And there are his numbers, leading receiver yardage-wise for Kaiser tonight. Carlisle has four catches, Procise and Hunter with one each. But again, no catches for Will Fuller.
Exactly. And he is their big play guy that takes the top off coverages, beats people downfield no matter how they play him. And Boston College has been doubling.
Just three catches for Fuller last week against Wake Forest in the Notre Dame victory. Play clock gets all the way down to two. Kaiser flings it to the near side, and this is a good gain for another first down for Brown, who's been the man for Kaiser.
Just a great job. I believe Notre Dame had a weak side run called, and he saw a rotation down to the weak side, got out of the play and throws the ball out to the left for the wide receiver screen. Great job by Kaiser recognizing late rotation of coverage and going out to the pretty much like an audible wide receiver screen.
So Notre Dame with a 10-3 lead now with first and goal at the Boston College 9. And to the 5-yard line is Hunter, Torrey Hunter. With the carry, Steven Daniels on the stop for the Eagles.
Torrey Hunter taking a handoff and carrying the ball. He's very versatile. Wide receiver, had an excellent year so far. Also messing around a little bit over there as a nickel defensive back, trying to play both ways. Described as a total football player.
So second and goal, ball at the 5.
This has been the trouble area for Notre Dame today.
Remember Josh Adams fumbling on third and goal from inside the 1. Irish trying to avoid another turnover here, already 4 in the first half. The fake to Adams, and Kaiser, who's had good success running in for touchdown scores this season, is stopped for a loss. Kevin Kavalik and Steven Daniels combine on Kaiser.
Daniels is a beast. I'm sorry. He throws people around, penetrates in the backfield. Very physical defensive front and linebacker core for Boston College. You're going to have to trick him down on the goal line. It's very difficult to run the ball in here. Kaiser's going to have to deliver an accurate throw. It's got to be precision down here.
Fuller in motion to the near side. Kizer flipping it. Ball's loose and it's intercepted. Intercepted at the 2-yard line. The third pick of Kizer tonight. Justin Simmons for Boston College.
I believe it was Goodapple in the middle that deflected this ball and tipped it, and Simmons was able to come up with it. Here's Fuller. He's great at these wide receiver screens, and it's traffic, collision, you get hit. But it was Goodapple getting a hand up on the ball and tipping it 97.
That is the fifth turnover of the night. Third pick, two fumbles, and three of the five turnovers have been in the red zone. Boston College survives another one. The fiery defensive coordinator for Boston College, Don Brown, firing up the troops. Just watched his defense force its fifth turnover, third in the red zone, and Boston College, deep in its own territory, takes over, trailing 10-3 as we approach the 9-minute mark. So you've got C.J. Procise on the sidelines, out of the game on crutches. Kizer throwing his third pick of the night. 10-3 game against a real underdog here for the second week in a row, and the fourth-ranked Fighting Irish of Notre Dame. That position in the college football playoff rankings looking more precarious as the minutes go by in this game. Second down and 7. Fadul gives it on the ground. And this is Richard Wilson getting his first carry of the night.
And it's been 2 weeks in a row that Notre Dame has looked a little out of whack offensively. You know, not quite there, not finishing drives, making mistakes.
And that is Louis Adazio, the son of the coach Steve Adazio, on the ground. He transferred from Syracuse when his father got the job here at Boston College. So dad comes out to check on his son, Louis. And we'll step aside and be back to Fenway in a moment. Coach's son, Louis Adazio, has made his way off the field, but they're checking out his left shoulder. In the meantime, there's been a change at quarterback. Fadul is out, and Jeff Smith is now in for his first play of the game, and he gives it to Richard Wilson. So here's Jeff Smith, one of four quarterbacks used by Boston College. Darius Wade was injured. He started things off for the Boston College offense. He was injured against Florida State, so Jeff Smith came in, and he traded back and forth and starts with your nephew, Troy Flutie, before they've made the switch a couple of games ago to Fadul, and so now they go back to Jeff Smith, who had a good week of practice.
And Jeff Smith is more mobile, very athletic, runs the zone read well.
And has very good speed, and there's an example of it here. Smith breaks in to the secondary across the 30. Ball went out.
No doubt that was down.
That's a gain of 13 for Jeff Smith, the freshman from St. Petersburg, Florida.
64, Harris pulls and kicks out. He follows his back up into the hole and cut backside. Exceptional running, good vision. Boston College has had three or four straight run plays now with good positive yards.
Jeff Smith got the start in the loss to Clemson. Then he was injured. He suffered from a concussion in the Louisville game. So that's when Flutie took over the controls. And this is Tyler Rouse who takes over this carry on first down.
By the way, you mentioned Troy Flutie, my nephew. When I said earlier I got my scouting reports from my nephews, that's my other nephews that just live and die with every Boston College game. I want to clarify that Troy is not talking about his teammates. Troy got some opportunities to play this year. I'm very proud of him. But Fadul has been shown to be the guy that has really kind of put a little fire in the offense. But it's not translating into points right now.
Second and 6. Here's Smith with his first pass. And is that caught? Yes. Right near the 38-yard line by Thad Smith. He was the guy that dropped one earlier in the game. And that moves the chains for Boston College out of a deep hole here after the turnover.
Nice grab, full extension, hug it to the chest. That's a good catch. And Jeff Smith has struggled completing passes within this offense. His thing is running the football, running the zone read, running option type stuff. And that's his strength.
All the schools, when Smith was being recruited out of high school, wanted him as a cornerback. He wanted to play quarterback, and here he is with a big opportunity tonight with another carry across the left side.
In fact, if Notre Dame can get a couple of stops on first and second down and cause a third and long situation, you may even see Fadul come into the game for passing situations.
Fadul through the air tonight, 4 of 12 for 44 yards.
But all the quarterback stats have looked like that. We just showed 30% for Jeff Smith throwing the football as well.
Quick hit. That's Smith again, and Notre Dame is right there to bring him down for a loss. Elijah Shoemate in that sea of green on Smith, and Jarrett Grace also a part of the stop.
Jarrett Grace getting on the field and getting a tough spot for the receiver to make a play. He has to turn his body, gives the defense time to react. Shoemate, Grace, it's great to see Jarrett Grace on the field after just a horrific leg injury he had a couple of years ago.
And with the injuries to other defensive players for Notre Dame, it's given Jarrett Grace a chance to get back on the field. Daniel Cage been injured, and he's back in there, backing up Greer Martini, who's been forced into the starting lineup for the Notre Dame D. Big play here on third and seven. Smith juggles it and falls on it at the 30. So end of series for Boston College after the turnover. So Jeff Smith comes in for Fadul, and the Boston College offense
he showed a little promise, hit the creases with the runs, and you just have to be a multi-dimensional guy. You've got to be able to do everything. So each quarterback has their strong suit, but so far this year, Boston College has not found the guy that can do it all.
On fourth and 18, Alex Howell with a nice high-hanging punt that Sanders calls for a fair catch, and this time catches it and doesn't try to run with it. So Notre Dame takes over the football. Five turnovers tonight for the Irish, who cling to a 7-point lead. 4:22 left in the third. Notre Dame with a 10-3 lead. Time for the game update presented by Sprint. Amir Carlisle scoring the game's only touchdown as Notre Dame led 10-0 after the first quarter, but then the turnovers really started piling up. Five forced turnovers, three picks thrown by Deshaun Kizer, along with two fumbles, one by C.J. Procise before he had to leave the game with an ankle injury. So the 1,000-yard rusher for Notre Dame is out of the game. And the Boston College offense, Doug, well, business as usual, sputtering and trying to stay in the game on the strength of their defense.
Well, it is time for Notre Dame to look like the number four team in the country. Time to put those mistakes behind you and move the football.
Fake it to Josh Adams, and Kizer rolls right up the middle for a decent gain. Connor Wojak stops him.
And every time they're in that situation that I just spoke of, where it's time to do something, they go to a quarterback run and get Kizer involved in that running game and start to move the chains. However, they haven't been able to finish drives.
Kizer telling us yesterday he's got to maybe slide a little bit more, because in high school he was the biggest player on the field. 6'4", 230 pounds. You've got some bigger and more physical athletes now at the college level, and he has to be a little more careful, especially with the team that's on the other side tonight. They have been flying to the football. And he gets rid of this, and it's complete on second and five to Alize Jones, who makes his first catch of the game. The leading receiver as far as the tight ends go for Notre Dame, with Durham Smythe, who was lost for the season earlier. Just short of the first down is Jones with his 11th catch of the season. Brings up third and short.
That was a pretty hefty blitz by Boston College, but they turned Josh Adams free on a free release. Now it's third and short.
And Matt Milano is flying around that edge. Here he comes around the right side. Kizer gets rid of it. They pick up the first down, and it is Amir Carlisle with his fifth catch of the night. Once again, still no Will Fuller.
So I believe that Notre Dame's best opportunity to move the football is to spread it out and run those quick rhythm passes where guys are picking for each other, cause some confusion with the Boston College secondary.
From the 45, it's Kizer again looking for something along the right side. Nowhere. Maybe got a yard. Second down and 9. Justin Simmons brings down the big quarterback.
Just a great job of staying home by the Boston College defense. playing your responsibility. We saw it earlier in the game where the give back was crushed just as the quarterback got crushed. So everyone's doing their job on defense.
And talk about doing a job. Wake Forest doing a job on Will Fuller last week. Just three catches, no catches tonight. And so one of the most dynamic players in the country has been neutralized by some of the top teams. There's Will Fuller, and he can't hang on to that. And that has been, if there's one thing about Fuller through the years, if you had to pick at something, he does have a tendency to drop some passes.
You're getting a lot of tough man-to-man coverage. So run crossing routes, under routes, pick for each other, rub people off. Finally, Will Fuller gets free, and he would be out the gate on the backside here, and he drops the ball. Part of that is he hasn't seen the ball all day.
Third down and nine now. As Fuller is split to the bottom of the screen. And from the 47, Kaiser stepping up in the pocket. It closes out, gets rid of it, and there's Will Fuller. Fuller for a big gain, first catch of the game, weaving his way down to the Boston College 21 before Connor Strahan finally brings him down. So Fuller breaks big in his first catch of the night.
Great job by Kaiser, hanging on and waiting for this to happen. Fuller up the field. He's going to get a defender from the inside, outrun it, get to the middle of the field where things are open. Receivers are getting bracketed, so if you can bust past the inside defender, there's a lot of space in there. And great job in traffic, stepping up in the pocket and delivering the ball by Kaiser.
Heck of a throw by Kaiser with the pocket crumbling on. Good for 32 to Fuller. Josh Adams now the top back for Notre Dame with ProSize out. Good gain for him.
Okay, coach, time to tell you guys in the huddle, hold on to the football. Do not put it on the ground in this area of the field. If they get inside the 10, I wouldn't be surprised Brian Kelly calls a timeout and tells them all, come on over here. Now look, hold on to the ball.
Kaiser on second down and one, going right to the fade route, and what a catch by Chris Brown. John Johnson was all over him. It was a timing jump by Brown, and he gets it for the six.
Great position to make the play. Johnson turns, sees the ball, and Chris Brown just takes it away. Goes up, two hands, strong on the ball, no interference either way, both hands, and just pulls it out and hangs on to the football. Unbelievable individual effort.
Brown, the leader of the wide receiving corps. Fuller, as we mentioned, the star, but no one more respected than Brown, and he has come up big tonight. His fifth catch, 95 yards. That touchdown pass good from 12 yards out, and Kaiser, who couldn't get it down, is now running with it after the hold exploded on him and just wings it to the sideline there for Nick Wisher. So that one keeps the score 16-3. But Chris Brown in a mano a mano duel with John Johnson wins it. Both of them had their four hands on the ball before Brown just wrestles it away for another touchdown for the Irish.
Jimmy Roberts in the studio. Five undefeated FBS teams to start the day. Ohio State and Houston lose. Now Oklahoma State is on the ropes. Chris Johnson lighting it up. Here a 39-yard touchdown toss to Jay Lee. Bears up 38-14 behind a quarterback who started the year as a wide receiver. Dan?
Thank you, Jimmy. Here with the manually operated scoreboard on the Green Monster, they're a little behind that Baylor score. Oh, wait a minute.
It's turning.
Come on, guys. You got to be quicker than that. They're going to bring it to 38-14 here in a moment, and there it is. You're up to date here on the out-of-town scoreboard.
Just like 1926.
Boston College trying to get some good field position here to start off this drive, trailing 16-3 after Notre Dame missed the extra point. That's Michael Walker, who earlier ripped off the big 67-yard kickoff return to set up the BC field goal. It's only points of the game so far. So what do you do here? You got Jeff Smith, looks like.
I was thinking Padul was going in there, but Jeff Smith, who looked very athletic and broke a few runs, completed a short pass last drive, but also put the ball on the ground in the backfield and lost yardage. They can be explosive with athletes if they can get in space, but the passing game is just pretty much non-existent.
That has been the story of the year for Boston College. Lots of injuries. They lost their starting running back as well. John Hillman injured his foot earlier in the season. He was the leading rusher for Boston College. So not only did they lose their starting quarterback, Darius Wade, they lost Hillman. So like Notre Dame, who's had a plethora of injuries, Boston College, especially on offense, has had to deal with those.
They really have had injuries all year, and a young offensive line and all that, inexperienced offensive line. But now with Jeff Smith at quarterback, safeties are going to be closer to the line of scrimmage. You may have some shots down the field, but I would anticipate Notre Dame playing run first.
Smith has time and throws it to the sideline, and it is complete to David Dudek for a big gain. So Jeff Smith with a little confidence builder to Dudek for 20.
Stepped in, watched the corner route out of the slot position. He's just going down and going towards a great coverage on the play. Shumate undercuts looking for an interception, but the ball was perfectly placed over the top.
But the flag is down and it is coming back. An illegal formation against Adazio's team, and that'll set him off for a few more seconds.
You make a play and it gets called back. You had an opportunity for a big play down the field and the ball gets dropped. An offense that does not consistently move the ball has to take advantage when they have those plays.
Final seconds ticking down of this third quarter. Jeff Smith gives it, and a good gain by Richard Wilson, but on second and 14, that's going to bring up third and long as we've reached the end of three. Dazio has seen his team implode. Notre Dame has seen more than its share of mistakes with the five turnovers, and through three at Fenway Park, Irish 16, Boston College 3. You're watching Notre Dame football on NBCSN. Final 15 minutes. Coach Steve Adazio of Boston College has just been assessed an unsportsmanlike penalty. He has been on the edge all night. Earlier we showed you that he had been given a warning, and finally the officials here had enough. And there's the flag coming in on Adazio, who's been fired up all night.
He shows his emotion. He gets out into it all the time. He steps out, and you know, if you're going to do that, keep far enough away that the ref is not going to feel threatened. You know, if the yelling and screaming's coming, it's got to come from a distance. You can't be right up on a guy and getting after him.
But it just cost his team, yep, 15 yards. So Jeff Smith and company backed up to their own 20, trailing 16-3. Smith's got plenty of time. He can run it, and he will. Gets up to the 30-yard line, so he gets 10 of it back. It'll bring up fourth down. Andrew Trombetti brings down the quarterback speedster.
Well, on third and 21, Notre Dame dropped back in a soft zone with a three-man rush, and Romeo Okwara just kind of mirrored the quarterback there and minimized the gain. He was the spy on an athletic quarterback and just kind of mirrored him and allow Boston College to just punt the ball away.
So here's Howell, who's been racking up the punts. He's got the
setting a record,
school record. Oh yeah, he's long gotten it, Doug. Four punts away, and now another one on the way. And this one is dropped by Sanders, and he reels back at the 21-yard line.
The punt game all night and punt return game has been an adventure for both teams.
Everybody losing the handle. Adams and Procise. Well, you can visit blueandgold.com and the Rivals Network for the most complete coverage of Notre Dame football and football recruiting on the web. Enjoy detailed scouting reports, recruiting updates, insightful analysis, and much, much more at blueandgold.com. Well, first time ever in all green, Notre Dame comes out in the seventh edition of the Shamrock Series. They have a perfect 6-0 record in the series, which began in the Alamo Dome, and that'll be the next venue next year for the latest Shamrock Series. And there's the Boston College throwback uniforms as well. So special uniforms, special night at Fenway Park. Just the beginning of the fourth quarter. Kaiser with a play action face. Wide open is Carlisle. And Carlisle all the way down to the 40. 45, and the ball is loose again. And Justin Simmons has it. But did they call him down?
When you're trying to bracket receivers all over the field, occasionally there's miscommunication. Out of the slot, no one picks up Carlisle down the field. Now at the end of the run, protect the ball. I'll tell you what, Simmons, 27, a heck of an athlete defensively. He is all over the field.
And the ball just gets loose there, but no fumble. Josh Adams on the first down carry, trying to turn the quarter, gets it inside the 40 after that big game for Carlisle, 33.
And his forearm definitely hit the ground, the elbow touching the ground. The ground cannot cause that fumble. That's a good call. But again, protect the football, Notre Dame. And I'll tell you, like I said about Simmons on defense, he is just extremely athletic. He looks like an NFL caliber athlete out there.
Everybody having a hard time holding on to it. And you even saw Deshaun Kizer on the missed extra point. It was a good snap, and he bobbled it. So that's why we stand at 16-3 instead of 17-3. That one skids into the turf next to Torrey Hunter Jr. And we talked about it, the extra point attempt. And it was a good snap by Daly, and right in and out of the hands. And then by that time, it was too late for Justin Yoon to take a swipe at it. So, you know, not Kaiser's night tonight.
A little bit of a cool night. The hands might get clammy, but he plays full time, so he's broken a sweat, and I just would not expect that out of Kizer.
So third down and three for Kizer. Pass complete. First down to Corey Robinson. That one good for 15 as Robinson breaks into the column with his first reception of the night. William Harris on the coverage, and as always, the Admiral is Dad David Robinson on the sidelines here, right out in that back of that end zone.
Well, that's his spot at Notre Dame Stadium. He's in that end zone down in the corner, so he's going to keep his same vantage point.
Dexter Williams has checked into the Irish lineup, and he gets his first carry of the night. Nowhere to go as he loses a yard or two.
Well, he's an explosive. He's an explosive back as well. He's another freshman. He and Josh Adams are good buddies. They went through training camp together, helped each other learn the offense. They roomed together all through camp. And both of them, very explosive backs.
Adams back in, second and 12. Getting close to the 20. Justin Simmons on the stop. That'll bring up third down.
The common thread, though, is even on a good gain by, that was very well blocked by Notre Dame, a nice little gain on the play. Boston College sticks you. I mean, when they get a chance to hit a running back and strip them, that's why the ball comes out.
Goes down as a reception for Carlisle, is seventh of the night. He's at 99 yards. He and Brown have combined for almost 200 yards, the two of them. Fuller with a single catch still so far tonight. And that is good flying defense on Amir Carlisle by William Harris.
It's a matter of learning or knowing the down and distance. Harris playing off and soft, allowing the flat route to be open, and then just react up. Right away, he looks open in the flat. Give me the ball, give me the ball. It hangs in the air just a little bit. But Harris is just sitting flat-footed off and watching. And once that ball was in the air, broke on it, made a strong tackle.
So here is Deshaun Kizer, who gives a rub of the hands here. And so Justin Yoon, who made a 30-yarder earlier in the game in the first quarter, this one from 35 yards out to extend the lead. This time, Kizer gets it down, and Yoon does his job. So 10:35 left in the fourth. Notre Dame ups the lead to 16 on Boston College. Notre Dame football on NBCSN is brought to you by AT&T. DirecTV and AT&T are now one, bringing television and wireless together. By Sprint, the official wireless sponsor of Notre Dame Athletics. And by Sears, house experts for homeowners. Oh, that is a tough ride, Doug, with Thanksgiving around the corner.
You know,
is he worried? He's worried.
That fine feathered friend is a little safer.
I am not a turkey. I am not a turkey. I am an eagle. Now,
yes.
Yes, I am. Please don't mistake me. I'll tell you what, that mascot uniform looks a heck of a lot better than it did back in the 80s.
Really? Is it?
So, oh, it was terrible.
So it's a good thing they didn't go with a throwback Eagle mascot outfit, as Michael Walker is corralled just short of the 20-yard line.
We had some kind of makeshift Eagle head and a pair of gym shorts, and that was about it.
And on this night where Notre Dame is in all green for the first time, there is the real throwback. Doug Flutie poised for another pass completion.
You know, I love throwing in the looser jerseys, but you get grabbed and pulled down all the time. So these form-fitted Under Armour jerseys, nice and tight, and you just can't get a hold of them, you know. You got to hit the guy. You can't just grab him by the jersey and throw him down anymore.
Yeah, missing also is that that stripe right down the helmet. Yeah, that was part of the throwback helmet days of
I love Oregon. The all-gold helmet, just like Notre Dame's helmet. There's his own read, yeah. Off and run, and goes just see it.
Run by Jeff Smith, and he is off to the races, and no one's going to come close to catching him. And all of a sudden, with 10:17 left, with thoughts of Notre Dame running away from the Eagles, that is an 80-yard touchdown run by Smith. And they're going to go for two to make it an 8.1 score game.
Montero at left tackle held his block. Jalen Smith, number 9, reads the zone. He goes after the back, boom, opens a crease, and I'll see you later. Jeff Smith can run. That's one thing he can do, and he can do well.
Elite speed by Smith. And so Adazio is going to go for two with a score 19-9, trying to make it 19-11 and pull them within a touchdown and another two-point conversion. Believe this, Doug. It's just when you think Notre Dame's got control of the game, Jeff Smith rips off an 80-yard run, now trying to go for two. And he didn't get the playoff.
Play a game. Offense.
That has been
five-yard penalty, try for point.
The story for Boston College all year. Something good happens, and then you just kind of nullify it a little bit. Now, they still need to go for two here no matter what. And it all stems from Notre Dame allowing Boston College to hang around with all those turnovers. They dominated three-quarters of this game, Notre Dame has. But the game is not out of reach.
So now they move it back to just outside the 8-yard line. Smith looking for Elijah Robinson, and it wasn't even close, so it stays 19-9. Irish by 10. So they get the penalty, move them back, and Smith is unable to get Adazio the 2 points. So Boston College, though, with new life after Jeff Smith takes it the distance at Fenway Park to close the gap just a little more. Next Saturday at 5 Eastern Time, Southern University, Grambling State, meet the Superdome, and the tradition, of course, would not be complete without the famous Battle of the Bands at halftime. That's a limbo move that I'm sure that even the Notre Dame band couldn't pull off. It's the Bayou Classic next Saturday at 5 Eastern Time on NBCSN. Both bands represented here. Notre Dame band seated there with a green monster right behind them. Fenway Park. Beautiful Saturday night continues in Boston. And a particularly pretty night for the Irish. Boston College pulling to within 19-9. And this is CJ Sanders, who's had an adventure tonight. Fakes the sweep around and then keeps it and does not get to the 20. So he fakes the handoff over there to Josh Adams. And it has not been a good night for DeShone Kizer.
Now, we've seen a polished DeShone Kizer all year long. And this tonight, bad decision forcing a throw. This one, he has an opportunity up time against Johnson, but he's got Will Fuller, his speed guy, at the bottom with separation. When you see Will Fuller one-on-one, you got to go to it. Forces the wide receiver screen in traffic. It's tipped. Even on an extra point, the ball slips out of his hands. It's just one of those nights where things are not in sync for Deshaun Kizer, and he has been phenomenal all year long. Stands in the pocket. He's delivered some strikes, but it's just not been his night.
There's our quarterback comparison brought to you by the Lincoln Motor Company. Remember, John Fadul started the game, so this is Jeff Smith in limited duty there with that big 80-yard scamper. And right now, Boston College's defense is playing fired up, sensing that if they can maybe force another turnover, get the ball back, maybe, just maybe, they can pull off a stunner.
Absolutely, and that's Boston College's strength is their defense. Connor Strahan, running from the middle linebacker position, runs his play down laterally. Great athlete. He's a young guy that's going to be the future at middle linebacker for Boston College.
Adams, who's already got three 100-yard games, held to 24 yards on 10 carries tonight. More pressure on Kizer, does get rid of it, going downfield, and that's a beauty by Will Fuller. Gabriel McClary could not stop the speedster Fuller from a huge gain of 33.
With an unblocked rusher in his face, Kizer delivers this ball. Little bit of separation, not much. Again, Will Fuller, when he has one-on-one coverage and tight coverage, has a knack for that last second separation of slowing down and then re-speeding up to the ball.
So the second catch for Fuller is a big one. And then plunging in just across midfield is Josh Adams, and a flag is in.
But those are the plays we've seen Will Fuller make all year long.
And how about this fourth player in Notre Dame history?
Offense, number 78, 10-yard penalty, first down.
That one's on Stanley, but now Notre Dame has a 1,000-yard rusher and a 1,000-yard receiver in the same season. It's just the fourth time in Notre Dame history that they've had that combo, but more in the mind of Brian Kelly tonight is getting out of here with a win. And again, you've got the College Football Playoff Committee watching, Doug. Style points right now, not much for Notre Dame, even if they're able to come up with a win here tonight. Play clock down to two. Kizer on first and 20, incomplete. Second and 20, he wanted Robinson.
Either Kizer rushed the throw a little bit there, or Robinson took it a step or two too deep. It was a quick rhythm pass that just the timing was way off. And that this is a ball that should never be incomplete. You got an off corner, easy hitch route, step and throw. So either the route was deep or the throw was too short and too quick.
Second and 20. Kizer dumps it over to the middle to Fuller, who all of a sudden has made his presence known.
Brian Kelly said that they were going to move Will Fuller around tonight and try to do some different things to get him loose so that the double teams couldn't happen. The crossing the field routes have been his best opportunity to run away or run out of a double cover. He just comes up underneath and keeps coming all the way across the field, running away from his defender.
There's an example of that press on Fuller that Don Brown, the defensive coordinator, said would happen, giving Fuller a little shot as he came off the line.
Yeah, but if he releases upfield, there's always a safety over top helping out. When he releases across the field, someone else has to find him to pick him up.
So Fuller gets some of it back, but it's still third and long. They need 11, and they get it. No, not able to hang on is Fuller. Gabriel McClary, that talented sophomore corner that Don Brown loves, was on the coverage and gave Fuller a smack as the ball arrived.
Boy, Will Fuller, as quality a receiver as he is, he's had his share of drops. Now, when he comes back to this ball, come back through the ball and catch it. Don't wait for it and let it get into your chest, because now the defender's closer and the hit happens pretty much simultaneously as the ball arrives.
So another coming big back. Stop for Boston College's defense forces Notre Dame to punt. And it's Thad Smith who awaits the Tyler Newsom punt. And this is a big one. He's just going to let it go over his head. It lands into the end zone for a touchback. So Boston College, with 7:43 remaining and trailing by 10, will take over. Beautiful shot high above Boston's Fenway Park, and beautiful coverage provided by Goodyear. Whether you drive 100 yards or 100 miles, choose Goodyear tires for superior performances, Goodyear, more driven, latest version of football at Fenway Park in that gridiron laid out there, but not exactly a memorable night for Deshaun Kizer and company. Five turnovers for the Irish. And now Boston College taking over at its own 20, 7:40 left. And they get it just across the 20 to Richard Wilson. Wilson with his sixth carry of the night.
Trombretti with the tackle. He was just totally unblocked on the play, closed down and made the tackle. A lot of mistakes in the offensive line for Boston College, whether it's pass protection, whether it's the run game, but they hover around and look for the big play.
Jeff Smith replaced John Fadul, the walk-on freshman quarterback, in the second half. Bit of a low snap. He is able to give it to Wilson again, who all of a sudden has become the most popular ball carrier. Isaac Rochelle on the stop.
Rochelle just did a great job of standing the center up. It's tough sledding up inside. We've talked all year about how strong the defensive front for Notre Dame has been,
and the screen game continues on the sideline.
Just look at this. It's fun.
I got to get the best looking screen though to Notre Dame.
Yeah, I'll
Boston
definitely.
College came back with the towels that they had earlier, but Notre Dame came to play with it. I think heavily logoed screens.
You get negative points for the towels, don't you, on the screen game?
Third down and nine. Smith trying to keep this drive alive, lofting it, and nowhere close to Elijah Robinson, and that'll bring up fourth down, and Notre Dame has a chance to get good field position on the punt.
Well, Robinson was trying a double move on Cole Luke, and it just wasn't going to happen. There really wasn't anywhere to put that ball. That was a missed opportunity for Boston College. Great job by the Notre Dame defense shutting it down, but you're trying to double move, a little slant and go in and back up by him. Cole Luke cut him off. The ball was thrown over the outside shoulder, and Robinson took it back to the inside late.
And Brian Kelly has seen enough of the punt receiving adventures by C.J. Sanders. Will Fuller, who is about ready to receive just the second punt of the season, calling for the fair catch smartly. So Fuller in for Sanders with a successful catch. 6:15 left. Notre Dame nursing a 10-point lead. Notre Dame up 19-9, and the world-famous Green Monster. You know, there's been a lot of tours around Fenway, but the best touring spot and location is inside the Green Monster, where our own Catherine Tappan has made her way behind the monster. Tapp, can you hear me?
Yes, I can, Dan. And in 1934, they added this manually operated scoreboard to Fenway Park. And just like they do during Red Sox games, tonight they've been updating the scores of all the top college football games going on throughout the country, including ours, of course. And if you're lucky enough to come down here, you may be lucky enough to make your signature known on the wall. Look at this, Neil Diamond of the famous Sweet Caroline that is sung here a lot at Fenway Park. So many interesting things here inside the Green Monster, including, Dan, I know you're wondering how I'm watching the game tonight. Well, I can actually see right out my own personal window right to you guys.
Nice, Catherine. You might want to sign the wall while you're in there.
I don't know. It looks like very, very famous people on this wall. Doug, have you signed this wall yet?
No, I'm not that famous. Neil Diamond, come on.
All right, Notre Dame with a first and 10. Kizer with a nice strike to Brown. Sixth catch of the night for Brown, and that's going to put him over the 100-yard mark.
I like the aggressiveness on first down, coming out, play action, and going after it a little bit. Notre Dame has to put this game away. If they're a number four team in the country, they should be able to do that.
Brown there with John Johnson, one of those aggressive corners of Don Brown's defense. It's a gain of 8 for Brown. He's got 104 yards on his 6 catches. And trying to pick up the first down. Should get it is Josh Adams. William Harris wasn't there in time to prevent Notre Dame from moving the sticks. So right now it's just like, you know, I guess clock churning time here, Doug, and get out of here with a win.
And the clock continues to run on the first down and all that. I thought there at second and one, Brian Kelly may have gone after the big play to put the dagger in there and put this game away. But controlling the clock, running it down. I know it's been a sloppy night for Notre Dame, but they're in control of this game. They want to make sure they get out with a win.
And again, with what is happening around the world of college football, a lot of people out there thought, well, you know, if Notre Dame just wins out, wins this game tonight, and then wins at Palo Alto next week, they're in. You know, they'll stay there in the playoffs. But you really can't think of it that way, because there's so much that can still happen down the stretch here in the final week of the regular season and then the conference championship games. I mean, I think Notre Dame's position in that number four slot has become even more precarious. But Ohio State losing to Michigan State on a last-second field goal earlier in the day. You got Clemson, who Notre Dame's only lost to, wins tonight or this afternoon against Wake Forest. And there's still just so many different combinations that can unfold. So Notre Dame's quest was to look good against Wake Forest last week. Not great, they didn't. And they're not looking good here again tonight. Kaiser, though, going down deep. That one looks pretty good, but it's dropped.
Wow.
Fuller with another drop.
Double move again. He goes a slant and go. He runs right by his defender. McCleary way off, but he bites on the move, and I'll see you later. We've seen it all year from Will Fuller. This we have not. He's dropped a handful of balls this year, no doubt about it, but tonight has been a rough night.
It's been like the Notre Dame circus at Fenway. All the drops, the fumbles. Dropitis here. That's Fuller's third drop tonight. Third and four. Kaiser is off the mark to Hunter. Didn't want to risk an interception there. He's already thrown three. But that'll bring up fourth and four.
I'm sure it's so enticing for Brian Kelly to want to go for things here and make some first downs and put the game. But you've got to punt it away. It's still a two-score lead. There's 4 minutes to go. Boston College offense has not done much at all. Kick the ball away and play defense.
Just contain Jeff Smith, right?
Yeah. Well, that's the problem. One guy gets in the open field, and it's a three-point game.
So Newsom is trying to pin BC back, calling for the fair catch is Thad Smith at about the 14-yard line.
And he still caught it up high over his head and caught a punt over him.
Stay tuned, folks. Notre Dame has had a hard time. Football's been like a bar of soap. Third drop for Fuller. 3:59 left. Boston College has the football, and John Fadul is back in for the Eagles. And with time running out on them, you think they got to get some passes complete here, Doug.
He did.
That one almost intercepted. Very catchable.
I was getting ready to say he did to Notre Dame, because this is a touchdown for Jalen Smith and he just drops the ball. Fadul is the passing quarterback. It's a 2-minute type situation. He's the guy that can throw the football, so he is in.
So why wouldn't Jalen Smith join the series of drops?
It's the theme of the night.
So Fadul hasn't been in since the third quarter, as Smith has had the last few series. That complete to Charlie Callinan. Max Redfield on the coverage.
What happens with young quarterbacks is as they go in, and the first time they're on the field, they're very confident. They sling it around and make plays. But when you start to have some negative experiences, whether it's interceptions,
personal
sacks.
Foul, illegal chop block on the offense, number 64 and number 77. Half the distance to the goal, second down.
So the old high-low between Harris Williams and John Baker.
Well, middle of the screen, number 98. Right here, Trombetti gets high-lowed and chopped.
Williams and Baker combining on that, and another setback for Adazio's offense. Now back at the 7, second and 17. Fadul looking to buy some time. Gets it complete to Callinan. It will still bring up third and long, though.
That's a heck of an individual effort. Stays alive out of his own end zone and gets a tough completion moving around. But with Fadul, he's looking one and done. He looks at a receiver. If that initial guy is open, he'll throw it. If not, I'm moving. And that's what young quarterbacks have to do a lot of times, because they can't quite take everything in.
Third and 8. Fadul steps up. Is he going to run it? Yes. Is he going to get the first down? Yes. That's Max Redfield, who finally brings it down. He is a tough guy. He's thick, 6'1", 215 pounds. And Fadul adding to his rushing total. If it wasn't for Jeff Smith and that big 80-yard rip, he'd be the leading rusher for Boston College. That one good for 15. Here's Fadul again going to work. Just slinging it out. And Tyler Rouse turns it into a decent gain after Fadul with a crafty toss. Cole Luke on the stop.
Being creative, trying to make some plays on his own, but his eyes drop. Like I said, he's going to look at his first guy. If he has a shot at it, he's taking it. He can throw the ball. He's got a strong arm. He can turn it loose. And he's athletic enough to extend plays and try to continue this drive.
Boston College down two scores, down by 10. 2:30 left. Fadul, another one complete. That is good for the first down to Callanan again.
Now up by two scores, Notre Dame only rushes three guys, drops in coverage, trying to keep things in front of them because Boston College does need two scores.
Eagles with two timeouts, Notre Dame with all three. As we approach the two-minute mark.
More zone coverage right now, dropping off.
Fadul, familiar. Pocket breaks down and he turns something out of it. Inside the Notre Dame 40 and comes crashing down. Hit hard, but not after another big gain by Fadul of 23.
Great job of sliding and moving in the pocket and just being an athlete, making a play, keep it alive, move the chains.
Fadul passed up Ivy League offers because he wanted a chance to play at Boston College, and Jeff Smith all of a sudden is back in the game.
You make a handful of plays, and now you had a quarterback change.
The completion. Short on the first down.
He turned that one. He slung that one, too. He just wound up like a baseball pitcher and turned that one loose right on the money. They're looking at Fadul on the sideline. Maybe he took a shot.
That was the first catch of the game for Harrison Jackson. Smith this time looked like he was going to go down, has more pressure and gets rid of it. The ball pops loose. That's Elijah Robinson, who got back on the football. Kavari Russell with a pop on Rouse to separate him from the ball, but Boston College recovers it. We've got an Irish player down inside the 25.
It's turned into schoolyard football. Pulls out of the grass with Sheldon Day. Stays on the moon and move, an athletic throw. Now wrap up the ball. Blindside hit, ball pops out. Boston College fortunate to get on it.
So Russell with that big hit is still down on the field. We're also taking a close look at Fadul. It looked like you got a helmet to helmet here. Wow.
Right on. And you know, we talk about his toughness and running hard. You just sometimes you're only going to get you might get an extra yard out of it, but in these situations, sometimes discretion is the better part of valor and go down.
Well, they're having an official review here to see if this is actually a catch. There's Smith spinning out of it, staying on his feet. Oh, that's
to me, that's a catch.
Gotta be a catch in a football move coming out of it, right?
Absolutely. Both feet on the ground, turns the body.
And then gets popped.
But what I was saying is the mentality of running hard, both quarterbacks, Jeff Smith, and now maybe, well, Jeff Smith had a concussion a few weeks back, and now Fadul running hard takes
after
a shot.
After further review, the ruling on the field stands. First down, Boston College.
And you need some stability at that quarterback position. So you pick your shots when you decide to lower that shoulder once in a while.
Other than Smith's 80-yard touchdown run, this is easily the best drive tonight for Boston College, working on an 8-play, 66-yard drive, approaching 1 minute left, trailing by two scores. Smith, right over the top. Again, he wanted Harrison Jackson, and a flag comes in.
Yes.
Pass interference, defense,
number 22. Ball will be placed at spot of foul, first down.
Shoemate with the flag.
A lot of bumping and banging. He was trying to run an outside release and get by Shoemate. Ball goes up, and there's all kinds of contact going on.
And as long as you keep the receiver in front of you, you can make contact. But once he's even, he's leaving, and you've got to get your hands off.
Yes, that Shoemate grabbed the collar of Jackson there, and that's what he got flagged for. So first and goal for Smith. Must score here for Boston College, and they get it. Charlie Callinan with 54 seconds left. And they'll go for one to make it 19-16.
Callinan in the inside, just running a little slant, getting inside his defender. Nice stick move, gets inside ball, nicely spotted, reaches up and snatches it. And Jeff Smith threw that off his back foot, falling away with pressure.
Boston College with a drive. Nine plays, 86 yards, just over 3 minutes. Colton Lichtenberg to add on that crucial extra point to bring the Eagles within a field goal with under a minute left.
It's onside kick time.
All out blitz, pressure coming after, man-to-man coverage. Great job beating your defender on the route, but Jess Smith falling away with pressure in his face, delivers a strike. Nice job reaching up and snatching it.
And even if this Boston College rally comes up short, you can't help but think about all the times in the past where Boston College has spoiled Notre Dame's season. Twice they've beaten the Irish when Notre Dame has been ranked in the top five. They're ranked fourth tonight as they still have a breath of a chance with an upcoming onside kick to recover that and maybe get a field goal or more. And there it is. They won in 93 and 2002. That 2002 contest, Notre Dame came out with the green jerseys as they were 8-0. They had just been off a win over top-ranked Florida State, and they were stunned by Boston College. So we'll see what happens tonight.
Well, this is the play of the game now.
At Fenway.
Two timeouts for Boston College if they were to recover this. Notre Dame recovers it, it's over.
Alex Howell, and Notre Dame comes up to recover it. That's Matthias Farley, who wasted no time.
The Notre Dame receiving team was not ready for that kick. Matthias Farley was very alert, attacked the ball, and a nice recovery.
Offside on the defense. 5 yards added to the end of the kick. First down, Notre Dame.
A lot of Notre Dame heads were turned and talking and communicating when this ball was kicked. There were a lot of guys not seeing this ball kick. Matthias Farley did. Scoops it up, moves forward. And if he moves forward to get the ball, he can't get hit until he touches the ball.
That was like Farley looked like a shortstop here at Fenway, just scooping that off the grass nicely, and then the penalty moves them up even further, and so Notre Dame with an excellent chance to just salt this one away. BC has two timeouts.
There is the potential that they would have to kick on fourth down, or at least run a fourth down kneel down. Is where there is the position they're in right now.
They use one of those two to stop the clock at 46 seconds.
There could be maybe 1 or 2 seconds and have to snap the ball on fourth down.
And a reminder, the Notre Dame postgame report coming your way with Liam, Hines, and Jonathan. They're right here with us at Fenway. They're going to look ahead to next week. Of course, Notre Dame heading to Palo Alto for their final game of the regular season. No conference championship, of course, for Notre Dame, taking on Stanford. Head coach Brian Kelly will join them on the set, plus Jimmy Roberts in our NBC studio. He'll have all the scores and highlights from another busy day around college football.
They move it back to 48 seconds, so there are 8 seconds that need to get wasted during two plays in order to run out the clock. And there's that final whistle and that final timeout for Boston College, stopping it with 42 seconds. Nnedi Abdismad bringing down Josh Adams. And so now powerless on third down and six.
It's basically done. They just need to run 2 seconds off the clock on this play, and the game will be over. They'll allow the clock to run all the way down and won't have to snap it on fourth down. But it's been a great effort by Boston College's defense. Notre Dame moved the ball exceptionally well at times, more on the Boston College defense than they've seen all year, but it's the turnovers. It was the defense that went in and stripped balls, came up with interceptions in crucial situations, and the inability of Notre Dame to stick the ball in the end zone in the red zone.
Well, as you look around Fenway, while we have a moment, just want to say thanks to the Red Sox Fenway Park staff here, just doing a tremendous job turning this baseball venue into a football venue. Colin Birch of the Red Sox staff, all of his grounds crew, the director of the grounds, David Meller, here at Fenway Park. I mean, you just, you know, you turn on your television set at home and you've got a football field placed down here at Fenway Park, but it took hours and days and weeks of preparation to get it ready. So the seventh edition of the Shamrock Series, a smashing success with the venue here and the feel and the buzz around Notre Dame and Boston College as they got ready to play, but not exactly a smile on the face of Brian Kelly and his players as they escape Boston College with a 3-point win. So last week at Wake Forest, 28-7 winners. They were 4 touchdown favorites over the Demon Deacons. And Steve Adazio's squad, mostly that defense, and a big play by Jeff Smith gave Irish a little scare tonight, though.
Really did. If there was any offensive at all in the first half by Boston College, this might have been a different game. Miscues by the number 4 team in the nation now, Notre Dame, looking for that playoff spot. Not pretty the last 2 weeks. And Stanford upcoming.
So Notre Dame makes it a perfect 7-0 in the Shamrock Series as we go down to Catherine.
Coach, you won the game, but what was the biggest frustration for you tonight?
Well, drop passes, turnovers, you know, they just obviously didn't play the best, but they played hard. Just sometimes, you know, you got 18 to 21 year olds and they want to play well, but today was not one of those games where they took care of the football, but they kept playing. BC played well today. They've got an outstanding defense, one of the best defenses we've seen all year. But we learned a lot from it, and I'd like to learn lessons and win football games, and we were able to win today, turning the ball over as many times as we did.
With the health of C.J. Procise and Kavari Russell now in question, how big of a concern is that for you going into your final regular season game next weekend against Stanford?
We'll find a way. These guys just keep battling. We'll get the next guy ready. Those are good players, obviously, and we'd like to have them, but you know, it's one game, and all we got to do is get our guys ready for Stanford. They're a great football team, but our guys will be ready.
Coach, thank you very much. Dan?
All right, so again, the walking wounded for Notre Dame, C.J. Procise with that ankle injury. They've already lost 6-7 starters, the latest count to injuries for the season. And Notre Dame, with the alma mater being played here, beautiful night at Fenway Park in Boston. Chance for a lot of the Irish fans to capture that special moment. I guess the positive outlook here is that, yes, the Notre Dame Fighting Irish ranked 4th in the college football playoff rankings, moved the record to 10-1, but the other side of it is that this was not a very good win.
Well, it was a weekend with upsets. And the bottom line is winning and moving on and still being in contention for that spot. But they need to polish things up. If they're going to have any chance against Stanford, they have to polish it up. Can't turn the ball over when it's unforced. And the ball was getting stripped out at the end of runs. And the interceptions that were forced throws, those things cannot happen. We've seen DeShone Kizer play well at times and look like a superstar. He has that ability. They need to clean it up.
And by the way, Stanford playing Cal right now has a 7-0 lead. They kicked off about 40 minutes or so ago, so everybody's going to be keeping a close eye on the Stanford Cardinal. Of course, the Notre Dame Fighting Irish going out to Palo Alto in a game that needs to, I mean, for Notre Dame's college football playoff rankings hopes, Stanford needs to take care of business to make that maybe a more impressive victory for the Irish when they get out there, if they're able to win on the road. That's not going to be easy.
Absolutely. Notre Dame still needs a big marquee win, and Stanford is that team and the team that's left for them. They need Stanford to win tonight, go after that game, and be impressive. It's going to be a physical football team they're facing, a very talented Stanford football team. You're beat up as Notre Dame. You're down to your third running back, and two freshmen are going to handle all the duties probably. It's going to be interesting.
And it's going to be fun to watch, but we'll be spectating as this concludes our Notre Dame on NBC and tonight on NBCSN football package. And Doug, just want to say what a pleasure it's been working with you.
It's been a great year. A lot of fun, Dan.
Emotional week for you, Boston College, and everything that's happened. So thank you for all you've done here on these telecasts. As we send you to Liam and company right after the commercial break, they're going to take you the rest of the way from Fenway Park. For Doug Flutie and Catherine Tappan, Dan Hicks, so long for now, but stay tuned here for more from Fenway.